The Honorable Governor of West Bengal, Shri Jagdeep Dhankar, has already arrived. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We welcome you all today and we thank you for joining us in today's session, Transforming North Bengal, an Industry Vision. We are extremely privileged and honored to have the Honorable Governor of West Bengal, Shri Jagdeep Dhankar, amongst us here today. We welcome you, sir, and thank you for gracing the occasion. Welcome, ma'am. I would now request the President of the Bengal Chamber, Mr. Deb A. Mukherjee, to formally welcome the Honorable Governor with a flower bouquet. Indeed an honor. Thank you so much. I'm so sorry in the I would now request the President of the Bengal Chamber, Mr. Deb A. Mukherjee, to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, Sharnali. Very good morning to all of you, ladies and gentlemen. I consider it a singular honor, and on behalf of all my colleagues at the Bengal Chamber, it's indeed our privilege to welcome His Excellency, the Honorable Governor of West Bengal, Shri Jagdeep Dhankarji. And also, we are indeed privileged and very happy to accord a very warm welcome to Srimati Dhankar, who has so very kindly come and is here with us this morning. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, madam, for having graced the occasion. A very warm and a very special welcome to our Honorable Shri Tathagata Rai Chaudhary, the former governor. Sorry, sir?
No Chaudhary.
I know. Apologies for that. And indeed, a pleasure to have you with us this morning. A slightly warmish morning, and certainly we do see the impact of climate change in this warm summer morning, which is not quite summer as yet, but we can feel it. And somebody was just telling me that the temperature might cross 40 degrees, possibly could be 41, and end of March, that's something very unusual. The reason, sir, why I mention this is that today our deliberations and the focus of our discussions as an initiative of the North Bengal Committee of the Bengal Chamber is to talk about a transformative change in North Bengal. And any change that we talk about, or any discourse, a meaningful discourse that we intend to have on North Bengal, cannot be decoupled or delinked from environmental considerations, from climate considerations, from the perspective of biodiversity, and the very sensitive nature of the region. The governor would be happy to know that we at the chamber, in November when we took over and started the new chamber year, we laid out a vision statement for the chamber. I will share, I know most of you are aware of it, but for the benefit of the governor, I'm going to share the vision statement with him. And I'm also going to share with him the initiative, just make a mention of the initiative we have taken towards realizing that vision during this chamber year, sir. The vision statement reads as, we as a responsible and responsive chamber, mind you, we are still riding the pandemic. In November, we were right in the thick of it. So the vision statement reads, we as a responsible and responsive chamber of commerce would like to help build the business of tomorrow with a supportive ecosystem that is inclusive and equitable, resilient and sustainable, and good for all. This is the strapline of our vision. And to support that vision, we have embarked on preparing an actionable vision plan for Bengal, and we call it Vision Bengal Moving Towards 2030, for the business of tomorrow, for the benefit of all. Indeed, this vision statement and this vision becomes so important, so pointed when it comes to North Bengal. Why? The simple thing, there are three aspects which we need to consider, as I said, for any meaningful industrial discourse, trade and commerce discourse on North Bengal. First, the political, the geopolitical sensitivity of the place, of the region. Second, the environmental considerations of the place. And the third, the biodiversity of the region, because the Eastern Himalayas have a very, very varied topographical layout. In order to take changes, ladies and gentlemen, can happen in different ways. You can have incremental change, you can have disruptive change. When you talk about transformative change, you need to be very, very careful, and especially in respect of North Bengal, to take a very balanced approach of economic development and link it with environmental considerations. No trade-off between economic development and environmental degradation, and that will be fatal. In Northeast, in North Bengal, there's also the challenge of ethnic and cultural diversity, which also need to be looked at. And all these aspects need to be considered when we are talking about a transformative change. Ladies and gentlemen, you would all agree with me that human and environment have had a symbiotic relationship ever since recorded history. Initially, humans were working in tandem, in conjunction with the environment. We were adjusting with the environment. And gradually, with our prowess, with our thinking, with our wisdom, we tried to mold the environment to serve our needs and at times going beyond our needs. And that has led to an imbalance in the biodiversity, in the environment, and the ecology around us. Of course, for North Bengal, we need to look beyond the three T's, as they say. Tea, timber, and tourism. We need to change the way business and industry would survive and thrive in a sustainable manner in that region. But we have to take, as I said, a very balanced approach. There are challenges in terms of hydrological, if you look at from purely the natural considerations, hydrological patterns, precipitation patterns, the biodiversity changes that we notice, topsoil erosion for agriculture, because of the uneven rainfall, water management, all these are issues that need to be looked at in a smart manner. New technologies need to be adopted, but at the same time, not to have a typically top-down approach, policy-driven top-down approach, without understanding the needs of the ground. So we need to dovetail policy with ground-level needs, involving community, involving trade and business, and all stakeholders. That is the balanced approach, ladies and gentlemen, we as a responsible chamber would like to facilitate. There are experts around, and they would be deliberating on what would be the way forward, the best way forward. But again, before I request the Honorable Governor to speak, of course, the chairperson of our North Bengal Committee, my good friend, Mr. Biswajit Mahanta, he is here. He is going to set the tone for today's discussions. But before I conclude, I would again like to extend a very warm welcome and express our gratitude to the Governor and his gracious wife for being with us this morning. Sir, we are indeed deeply honored. Thank you.
Chairperson of the Bengal Chamber North Bengal Committee, Mr. Biswajit Mohinta, to set the context for the day. Over to you, sir.
Good morning to you all. Before we go ahead, now the title of the conclave, Transforming North Bengal, an Industry Vision, says it all. But initially, His Excellency, Honorable Governor of West Bengal, Sri Jagdeep Dhankar ji, respected ex-governor, former governor of Tripura and Meghalaya, Sri Tathagat Roy, Madam Sudesh Dhankar ji, the president of the chamber, the dignitaries, and the esteemed audience. Really, it is an honor and privilege to have you all with us here. Especially, sir, we are indeed privileged to have you with us today here for the cause of North Bengal. Because really, North Bengal requires a transformation. The opportunities and the potential, this has to be really, as the president has very rightly put, requires a sort of a balanced outlook, and definitely the socioeconomic balance and the environmental balance, we have to really take care of it. Now, I'll just put a few points to really set the tone as it was put by the president. Now, initially before that, I will express my thanks and gratitude. Today, we have a lot of representation from the Darjeeling Hills, The first time in Kolkata, really we have a lot of programs from North Bengal, even in Siliguri, even in Kolkata, I found the representation from Darjeeling, which is the key and the core to the whole North Bengal's ecosystem, is missing. Today we have thought leaders, we have entrepreneurs, and we have a whole lot of, experts who will be really deliberating on the hills, actually. Now, coming back to our move ahead, as far as the North Bengal Committee of the Chamber of BCCI, now, the North Bengal Committee is committed to act as the nodal entity to support the holistic industry and socioeconomic transformation of the region, especially the hills, thereby taking it to the path of growth and inclusivity. As our president has put it very rightly, it should not be top-down, it has to be bottom-up. That is the way we have to move. So inclusivity is something which is the most important aspect of transformation, because if we cannot make an inclusive socioeconomic ecosystem, it ultimately doesn't benefit or doesn't really work for the growth or the future of the region. Now, just to mention, as far as this committee is concerned, we are again very thankful and privileged to have today, because of the election code of conduct, they are unable to be present and they're busy with the elections, that we have three honorable MPs in this committee as special invitees now. The Darjeeling Member of Parliament, Mr. Raju Bista, the Balurghat Member of Parliament, Dr. Sukanto Mojumdar, and Jalpaiguri Member of Parliament, Dr. Jayanto Roy, with us to really support us in our initiatives and give us their suggestions and help us to take it ahead. Apart from that, we have education expert, Padma Shri Dr. Ajoy Ray, as expert on our education advice, because the new education policy, that would be very important for transformation of the region. So unfortunately, he has just taken his first dose of COVID, So he told me that he should be excused. So he's not there with us. But he's very, very positively trying to support us in this committee to take the things ahead. Now, we would be very closely work with all the stakeholders, actually. That is very important, because we have to have a convergence of the stakeholders and bring the change in the ecosystem through necessary value addition. Because what happens is, as we see the North Bengal scenario, it is most a cost-plus economy. It has to be a value-plus economy. That is the transformation that will be required. Because cost-plus means, you know, it's more on a trading platform. Goods are made, services are made from other places, and it comes to the region, and it is simply delivered through a system of a cost-plus economy. So it has to be a value-plus economy. That is very important. So this change is very important for us. And the hills of Darjeeling, as I mentioned, again, I'll reiterate that, that plays an important role in our transformation of North Bengal journey ahead. And accordingly, nothing can happen in the region without the revival of tea and tourism. And this is our prime objective, and we will also connect the Sikkim hills in this, because Sikkim also farms on, geopolitically it may be separate, but obviously for the reasons of our activities, it should be together, and we will definitely work together with Sikkim also in this. The North Bengal essentially being the gateway to Northeast, we would work towards optimum integration on that, because that is very important, because we don't have much of really connect. It is happening in pieces of bits, but there is no, effort which is really concrete and which is really organized. So we will do that, and we will also have Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh in our ecosystem, because that is very important, because what is happening is these three regions, they play and they can further play a very important role. I should just mention of one of the initiatives of Government of India for Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji very recently. The rail connection between Haldibari and Bangladesh was opened for the reasons of the trade. And really, this is our wish. We would like to establish a special economic zone in Balurghat, which is one of the most, that is South Dinajpur, which is one of the most neglected districts. Out of the 8 districts of North Bengal, Balurghat is the most neglected district. And obviously, the economy has a lot of things to do. And this may be a way out to really bring up the economy of that district. Now, inclusive of North Bengal, there are two factors that is very important for the North Bengals going ahead in this transformation process. Is inclusion of North Bengal in the Northeast incentive regime, because we are all aware that Northeast gets a special benefit, including Sikkim, and that is extended till 2027 now, actually. And there is a donor ministry who is being looking into, taking care of all this. So really speaking, for the industry to go ahead, incentivization will be very important, especially we have to work towards including at least the 4 districts. 4 districts of Darjeeling, Kalimpong, Jalpaiguri, Alipurduar, in Kuchbihar, 5 districts to be precise, in this rim of this Northeast benefit scheme. And another part is expansion of Bagdogra Airport. It is most important for the infrastructure point of view and for the growth. I mean, it can work as a growth engine, really speaking, because we all have experience. When we pass through this airport, we see what state of affairs it is in. So this expansion is something also we have been trying. Last 2 years, actually, we have been really trying to put our bit to see that it happens. I think something has moved, but we have to really work further. Finally, it should be emphasized that our activities would be in lines with the environment and sustainability factors, which was very elaborately and very, very well put forward by our president. In fact, as a key to such transformation, because North Bengal cannot have any change can happen without these 2 factors. That is, one is environment and sustainability. This has to go hand in hand, especially the sub-Himalayan region. That is the Darjeeling Hills to Siliguri to the Jalpaiguri. This is the most sensitive ecosystem possible in India, actually. And really speaking, it has not been taken care as we have done in, say, areas like Simla or even Uttarakhand. There was a disaster very recent past in Uttarakhand. In spite of that, I should say, it's a wonderful sort of a job that is happening. Even our honorable minister was there last week. He was deliberating in, to the team of Bengal Chamber last week. The Jal Shakti Minister, Honorable Gajendra Shekhawatji, he said that the mission of Jal Shakti Mantrak was to see that the rivers coming down up to Haridwar, that it can be, it should have a transparent look, and they have achieved that. So we have to also achieve this Tista and other rivers coming down. We have to really look into this. And finally, I'm very happy to inform that in this direction, Mr. Mukherjee has already put. Sri Debe Mukherjee, the president of the chamber, is most supportive and has embarked upon an ambitious project titled Vision Bengal Moving Towards 2030, wherein sustainability is the core. So I will end with that, and I will really request all the stakeholders to be with us. And Honorable Sir, we'd like to hear you from you really and have your valuable suggestions to go ahead and take North Bengal to the path of transformation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I would now request the Honorable Governor, Sri Jagdeep Dhankar ji, to kindly deliver his address.
My greetings to everyone present here and to everyone who could not make it to this place on account of COVID protocol. But I'm sure they all are in sync and perfect connect with what we all are doing on this day. I recognize the gracious presence of Tathagat Royji, former governor, a writer, and I have fraternal connect also because he is a reputed arbitrator also. His presence here is daunting to me for a variety of reasons, which I will not reflect at the moment. Debe Mukherjee, the president of this chamber, a chamber that has a unique status, not only in India, but also in Asia. He also has a law degree that makes a perfect connect with me. In his discourse, he has been able to put it so rationally and incisively, capsuled everything, and I'm sure the deliberations that are to follow would take it to fructifying level. Biswajit Mohanty, his passion is irrepressible. I'm sure what he has in mind will translate into reality. Before I say anything, I need to remind all of you of the constraints I suffer on this day. Model code of conduct is applicable. Anything indicated by me in any manner whatsoever may be read one way or the other or interpreted. I am alive to the august position the chamber holds, the sublime motivations the chamber has. I would therefore be extremely cautious, but I would indicate to the president that next meeting or any meeting thereafter, with this agenda in mind, be kept at Raj Bhavan Darjeeling. Raj Bhavan will facilitate it. I had the occasion to open Raj Bhavan Darjeeling to the people of North Bengal when a cultural festival of the central government was held. Thousands thronged. They saw it for the first time. I was there on the last day. I changed my schedule to be there because not many people said you must come. After assuming the office of governor on 30th of July 2019, for a variety of reasons, due attention could not be paid to North Bengal. But I was there during winter and for one complete month. Darjeeling is not a place of resting for governor of state of West Bengal. It is his another office. Even at Kolkata, it's a camp office. So there is another camp at Darjeeling. I mean to devote more attention to it in times to come. I say so because, having spent 1 month, I know the enormous potential it has. I would indicate that briefly, without getting into an area that may be reckoned remotely as transgression of Model Code of Conduct. But sir, congratulations to you for being very thoughtful, very far-sighted. I have no doubt the third decade of this century will decide which way the world will go. The third decade will decide which way India will go. The third decade will decide what will be spinal contribution of the state of West Bengal. But I can say without fear of contradiction, what happens in North Bengal in the third decade will decide where West Bengal will be there and what will be contribution of West Bengal to India. The policy of the Prime Minister, a well thought out, well appreciated, well acknowledged, look east, act east, that cannot fructify unless North Bengal is transformed. It has unique feature. If you look at it in the context of global economy, geopolitical situation, there is hardly a place in the world that is so gifted by nature, so strategically located, and has so much enormous potential to be exploited. When I went there, the gateway to Southeast Asia, the real gateway to Northeast, is bound to be a marketing hub of a very different nature. I was not aware that we had 4 national parks, we have 6 wildlife sanctuaries and a tiger reserve. I was not aware. The world is not aware. We are unrivaled. Something has to be done. Someone has to catalyze it. I am at the right place. I am before the right people. Darjeeling was queen of hills. Not recently, long back. That has to be tapped. When I was there for 1 month, I went to Himalayan Mountaineering Institute, visited other institutes. Oh my God, what we have, and we are not aware. That is something which has to be done. I was talking to some friends, invited some of them to Darjeeling while I was there, and one of them said something very interesting, Tathagatji, very, very interesting, that if there is a place which has real suitability for yoga and natural therapy, it is North Bengal. When I went to Kalimpong, I was glancing through a book. All those who had visited Kalimpong, and I found Rorich, a great painter of Russian origin. I had the occasion to deal with some paintings on the litigation side because they were taken out of this country. There. So very different place. Let us tap it in national interest. I have to be in high alert mode for a variety of reasons, as I indicated. But this much I can say, time for us to reflect where we were, where we have been now, Can this slide continue? Should it not be arrested? Is there any premise which can justify on which this sliding down is continuing? Those who can change it are before me. Because facing all odds, facing a system that is required to be reformed, a system that generates hiccups for you, a system that is not very supportive, that being the situation, you create wealth, you develop a skill, you refine human resource, you are the driving force of micro and small industries. We have had, after I became governor, one governor's conference. Tathagat ji has been lucky, has had more. I was made convener of a group of 10 governors. All of them happened to be people with more understanding, reputation, expertise than myself. So I spoke to each one of them individually. People of great, great, great eminence. And we were to give a paper, Ease of Governance. I requested the government at the highest level that we will be able to do justice, because my mind was obsessed with West Bengal. We will be able to do justice only if an expert body helps us. So a directive was issued that Niti Aayog will assist us. I am beholden to Dr. Rajiv Kumar, to Mr. Kant, for rendering valuable service to us. We produced a paper. I was greatly enthused, Mr. Dev, after presenting that paper. And I thought, state of West Bengal is home to celebrated chambers. Yours is a flag bearer. So I wrote a letter to all the chambers that I would like to organize an interaction with the Vice Chairman, Dr. Rajiv Kumar of Niti Aayog, so that we can have way forward instance. I would not go into the issue why it couldn't take place. It shall take place. The people before me will make it possible. I express my gratitude for making this opportunity available to me. If I start rolling out what can be done, value addition in tea is taking place everywhere except in Darjeeling. In that area, North Bengal should be there. Education, health, all those issues are there. I have indicated constraints to all of you. You have appreciated my constraints. Maybe after 2nd May, I'll be happy to associate myself with any such venture. I have gone through the recording of one such exercise which took place in 2020, where we had several speakers. I saw it only the video of it. Sapan Das Gupta was one of them. All of them had passion, mission, vision. Someone has now to take a penalty strike. Only a chamber can take. Its history bears it out. Once again, thank you so much for giving this opportunity to me and the First Lady. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your kind words. We will now begin with our first session of the day, Transforming North Bengal. It is a panel discussion to be moderated by the chairperson of North Bengal Committee, Shri Biswajit Mohinta. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll just wait for a while for Mr. Mohinta to come back. So we now begin with a panel discussion, which I already mentioned will be moderated by the chairperson of the North Bengal Committee, Shri Biswajit Mohinta. Mr. Mohinta has around 3 decades of global corporate experience, having worked in senior and CEO and country manager positions of major transnationals, Indian conglomerates, and government enterprises like Grundig Electronics of Germany, Bata Global, Sika AG Switzerland, Videocon Group India, Webel, Government of West Bengal, India, as the CEO of Webel Consumer Electronics. Presently, he is an independent international industry and inclusivity strategist working on innovative projects in eastern and northeastern India with technology, investment, collaboration, and export, interfacing with Germany, France, etc. He is working with focus on Make in India, Startup India, and Skill India initiatives of Government of India, primarily in MSME and startup segments. As a part of the panelists today, we have Mr. Yogdeep Gurung. Mr. Gurung is currently the director of Glenmore International School. Prior to this, he was associated with the Endeavour Group as the CEO. He has also worked at MacLeod Russell India Limited and Williamson Meagher. He completed his schooling from St. Joseph's School, North Point, and St. Paul's, Darjeeling. He went on to complete his graduation in BCom honors from Delhi University. Mr. Gurung was associated with the tea industry for about 30 years, having worked initially for Warren Tea in Darjeeling and Williamson Meagher in Assam before heading to Duteria and Kalij Valley Tea Estates as the DM in Darjeeling. Requesting Mr. Gurung to kindly take his seat on the stage. Of the Duteria and Kalij Valley Tea Estate.
Himalayan.
Okay, sorry, my apologies. Himalayan Endeavour Group. The next panelist is Mr. Ashutosh Jaiswal. Mr. Jaiswal is the president of International Business, Shipping and Logistics Division of Century Plyboards India Limited. He is intensely involved in business planning, business strategy, operation management, supply chain management, strategic planning for international trade, shipping and logistics of the Century Group. He conceptualized, planned, developed, implemented, and marketed the first private sector container freight station at Kolkata. Mr. Jaiswal also implemented the total software technology basis the Digital India for both the CFS, including yard mapping, RFID, GPS, from the time of nomination of containers to delivery, giving a clear picture on real time to the trade. It is the first of its kind in the country, having total integration. Requesting Mr. Jaiswal to kindly take his seat on the stage. Our next panelist is Mr. Anoop Hoon. Mr. Hoon served in organizations like Asian Paints Limited, Dunlop Tires Limited, the Gramophone Company of India, HMV, Fortis Healthcare Limited, BOC Gases Limited, Bell's Controls Limited, Invigorsis Consultancy Private Limited, and Century Plyboards India Limited, from where he retired as the President of Marketing and Organizational Development. He is currently the chairperson of the Marketing and the Brand Committee of the Bengal Chamber. Mr. Hoon has done his graduation in economics from St. Xavier's College and holds a postgraduate diploma in international relations and personal management from XLRI Jamshedpur. Mr. Hoon is a certified executive coach with over 100 hours of coaching experience, specializing in leadership coaching. He was a guest lecturer at XLRI Jamshedpur and IIMC from 2001 to 2007. May I request Mr. Hoon to kindly take his seat on stage. Our final panelist for this session is Dr. Robin Chakraborty. Dr. Chakraborty is the chairperson of the Health Committee of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry and Senior Vice Chairman, Cardiology Services and Senior Consultant, Interventional Cardiologist and Electrophysiologist, Medica Hospitals Private Limited. Dr. Chakraborty is a renowned cardiologist based in Kolkata. Welcome, Dr. Chakraborty, on stage. May I now request Mr. Biswajit Mohinta to welcome the esteemed panelists with a flower bouquet. So we now begin the panel discussion. I'm sorry.
Last but not the least, Neil Gurung, and incidentally, we are the principal sponsors for today's program also.
Over to you, sir.
Good morning to you all once more. Now, at the outset, my apologies, you know, certain way of going ahead we couldn't do today because of the election code of conduct. Especially I'm feeling very bad that we have respected Tathagata Roy with us today, and because of certain restrictions, obviously we have not included him in the thing, you know, couldn't do that. So anyway, we'll be having a lot of such programs, as I said, that we will really transform North Bengal with all of your support and take it ahead to a different path of growth and success story as far as this transformation is concerned. Now, coming to the panel today, now I will just set the tone of the discussion. What we like to go ahead on is that, you know, creating for the transformation, we require to create a benchmark strategic industry and inclusivity model. That is very important, because whatever is happening, as I mentioned earlier also, that it is most on a very, what to say, isolated manner. It has to be on an organized strategic platform. It has to be brought together with an objective, with inclusivity. And in that model, you know, skilling, entrepreneurship, employability, employment, investment, infrastructure should be the key words actually. Because these are the factors which will really bring about the change in the region. Now, no region can be changed, or on any region, when if we go for a socio-economic transformation, obviously it's the interplay of different sectors, you know. Different sectors have to come into play as far as this transformation process is concerned. So as far as Darjeeling is concerned, or as far as North Bengal is concerned, tea and tourism would be the key sectors we have to transform. As our Honorable Governor has just mentioned that, you know, value addition is lowest. Even interestingly, Assam, and more interesting than that, a state of Tripura with which I'm working very closely at the moment, there's a tea development corporation, and it's a wonderful mindset. They're wanting to change, and you know, the value addition process is taking a different shape altogether. Now, I myself feel enthused speaking to them that, you know, before I tell anything, they come with ideas that let's do this, let's do that, in spite of their limited resources being a smaller state. Now, you know, these two would be the focus areas. Food processing is another area which would be really transformative. As my introduction was given, I was the CEO for the Videocon projects, which we had pledged, till 2011. Between 2006 and 11, we pledged an investment of around 50,000 crores, that is around 6-7 billion USD, if I go by the value of the dollar today. Now, food processing in North Bengal has been a very key part, and we had two special economic zones, which I was only taking care, but unfortunately, we couldn't really transform them into reality. Now, really speaking, coming back to the food processing part, this will be a game changer as far as North Bengal is concerned, along with tea and tourism. And obviously, we should not be, or we cannot be restricted to only Darjeeling. As I said, Darjeeling should be the core, but there are 8 districts, and 8 districts offer 8 different sort of opportunities. Now, if I come to start, say, Malda district, It has got a wonderful opportunity as far as floriculture, mango. And you see where Maharashtra, Alfonso, it's become a global brand. And we go to North Bengal, nobody knows. And the scenario as of today is that we were net exporters to Bangladesh mainly of mangoes. Now we are importers from Bangladesh. That is the present situation if somebody keeps a track of the present situation there. There was a food processing complex that came up, but it became sick. It was developed in 2010 actually. It's a wonderful food processing complex, which I was also incidentally associated because I've been working very closely with the last government in the initiatives. I was part of the WBITC, ICICI Winfra. ICICI Winfra is the agency which has actually was responsible for the Singur part also, which I was also part of. So there was a tea park that would have come up in Jalpaiguri, which never happened. And the food park has been closed now. So we have net importers from Bangladesh as of today of mangoes. That is the situation. So it is the same story in all the districts. Now, even in Darjeeling, again, I come back to tea and tourism, it is the same scenario. Now, health, which we'll hear from Dr. Robin Chakraborty, is another area that requires a transformation. Because, you know, if we really go to the places like Duars and all, which is adjoining Bhutan, even the patients have to come to way to the, Kolkata for their treatment. And which I should have mentioned actually, in our committee, we have Dr. Bikas Dewan. Dr. Bikas Dewan, incidentally, is again my school class mate. Now, he is the most eminent doctor at the moment in thing. He couldn't have come because 3 days being out of Darjeeling would have affected the patients. So he couldn't come, actually. He said Siliguri would have been a better place. Now, health is one area, public health and as well as health as a business. It can go through a sea change. And in this part, I should mention that there was a health city that was coming up in the model of Dubai Health City in Bardhaman. It was on a 60 acres land, and I was the strategic advisor on the request of the last industry minister, Mr. Nirupam Sen, to that project. That also unfortunately has not come up. Only a small building has come up. It is in a very sick state actually. We can do so. We can easily have a health city there, you know. It can be an international health city given proximity to Bangladesh, especially Bhutan. Bhutan requires that support, and as it is thing also, North Bengal also. So health. Education. I've done my schooling from North Point, Darjeeling. Most of my friends, including Yogdeep, is my classmate. Now, you know, really speaking, we had a wonderful standard of education, and that was an exportable commodity, because export part is very important as far as education is concerned. We had host of students, if you recall, Yogdeep, from places like Thailand, Bangladesh. Bangladesh was just formed that time. Even foreign places, even UK and France, we had people. Sweden, yeah, we had people coming from, you know, we had our school friends from all these countries. Now it's the other way around. They're all going to other states of India or outside the country. So this it's a totally dwindled situation. Now, higher education also is in a very, very dilapidated state. We have North Bengal University, the government university, couple of universities have come up, but only in form of building. I would be honest, and that's the reality. Okay, so unfortunately, we couldn't have Dr. Ajoy Day today. He could have put a better focus on that. Now, that is another area. It can be a net exportable opportunity for us as far as North Bengal is concerned, education. Now, agriculture. This can go with the new education bill in place now. Okay, it's on hold, but obviously, the provisions it has got, it can bring in a total transformation in agriculture in North Bengal. And as I mentioned that we are planning a special economic zone given the future of the state in Balurghat even. So now logistics, which obviously Mr. Jaiswal has put his thoughts together, because he was telling me that he has just come back from North Bengal last week only. So if, in a fresh manner, he can really enlighten us on that, the opportunities being a gateway to Northeast, even Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh. Now infra. Infra is the area infrastructure, as even the Bagdogra Airport expansion has got straddled. So this is an area where obviously government investment is there, and this is also in a situation of jeopardy, which is not working ahead. Now ICT, that is IT and communication technology. Some buildings have been built, but you know there are no activities. One or two companies came initially, as BPO and all, they have left the place actually. Now, above all, I feel this is a wonderful opportunity of the thing, you know, of the region to offer the maximum quality and the strength in form of service sector to the country, which they are doing. We have hospitality industry people because the English proficiency is very high of the region actually, English speaking proficiency. So that is very important. And finally, I think I will come to Mr. Hoon last on that, that another part is the image and perception revamping. That he's an expert, he will speak on it. So I will start with Yogdeep Gurung first, because he's been a man of tea industry. So in brief, Yogdeep, if you could enlighten us about the present and what you see, how we should take it ahead for the future, actually.
Good morning, everyone. I think rather good afternoon. I'm not really a tea expert, but having spent almost 30 years in the tea industry, I can probably share a few thoughts of mine. Tea industry all over in India are going through very hard times, whether it be Darjeeling tea industry or the Tarai and the Duas or Assam. And the problem is known to the industry tea captains. What is to be done? Basically, the problem which stands is of poor yields, which is almost half of what the optimum operating yields should be. The second is of quality. And third is the exodus of the manpower to the cities and other industries from the tea area. Now, basically, if you question why has the yields gone down to that level? For Darjeeling, at one point in time, the yields were almost 12 quintals, which has dwindled down to almost 4 quintals. Manpower being the same. So it is increasingly becoming very difficult for the tea companies to sustain the workforce in the tea estates. Almost 80% of the tea areas in Darjeeling and the Duas, I would say, are over 50 years old. And the quality and the yield of tea gradually disintegrates after the age of 50. Hence, some progressive companies have done 2% uprooting, replanting, thus keeping the age of the tea bushes within 50 years. But a lot of people have not. So the need of the hour is of uprooting, replanting, of infilling, of using better cultivars to produce quality, and which is known to most tea planters as to what is to be done. So why is it not being done? It is not being done because of the financial angle. There have been various ups and downs in tea. There were good times as well as bad times. Particularly now, we are going through very bad times. And therein, I think the government, both at the center and the state, they need to step in. Step in the sense that they need to provide cheaper loans, better subsidies. I think the subsidies which are provided for uprooting and replanting does not cover the loss in crop, because the gestation period in Darjeeling is almost 9 to 10 years. So the moment you uproot a tea plant, from the very next year, you're losing that much of crop. So the policies where subsidies are decided should take into consideration not only the cost of the replanting process, but sustaining the tea garden for over that 9 to 10 years period of time, when thereafter the tea bushes become productive. Secondly, very much less importance has been given to the R&D as far as tea is concerned, I feel, and especially in Darjeeling, on the art of tea making. I mean, some kind of research has been done in the field and the factories and things like that. But if you take the instance of China, which is considered the mecca of teas, there are six broad-based, you know, tea lines, I would rather say. You know, you have the white teas, you have the green teas, you have the yellow teas, you have the dark teas, you have the oolong teas, and under each of these heads, at least 100 to 150 different varieties of teas are made. So to sum it all, I mean, in China, you would probably have 1,000 varieties of teas. Whereas in India, it is just about, you know, you can count them in the fingers of your hands. We are still reeling under the, you know, the technology which had been left by the British. I think 99% of the tea gardens are still using the tea machinery left down by the British. No innovation, no research has been done as to how we can change our teas. As one planter recently told me, the tea area in Darjeeling stretches from about 1,000 feet to 6,000 feet. We are not making region-specific teas, which is the case in China. Every region has got a different kind of tea. But in Darjeeling, from 1,000 feet to 6,000 feet, everyone is producing the same kind of tea and competing with each other. Secondly, I would say the marketing aspect also needs to change. In China, you don't have the auction system. And I'm not suggesting for once that we should do away with the auction system, because the auction system does have its benefits and its plus points. But we can always think and try and get newer ideas regarding marketing and how to sell our teas. And for this, we need to research a bit. We need to look into the countries which have been successful following a different way of marketing. And last and not the least, I think we also need to deliberate, I mean the industry captains need to deliberate as to how we would run our tea gardens. See, in Vietnam, I have seen myself, the tea gardens are owned by the local gentry. In Vietnam, of course, most of the tea factories are run by the state. The state just buys the tea leaf from the workers. The workers are the owners of the tea estate, rather. The state runs the factory, provides the marketing, and pays the labor as per what kind of produce he brings into the factory, depending on the quality aspect and things like that. So because of the dwindling labor force, I'm afraid, I mean, in the next 20, 30 years, it would be extremely difficult to run the estates in Darjeeling and the Duas and in Assam unless we think out of the box and change the way the tea gardens are being run. So saying this, I think for the time being, I would like to take my leave because there are other panelists as well. And all the stakeholders, whether it be the government at the state or the center, the tea industry captains, the marketing people, the merchant exporters, everyone needs to sit together. A lot of tea conclaves, tea symposiums need to be held within the tea district itself, so that there is exchange of ideas. The machine manufacturers in China need to be involved so that we can import the machinery to make the various different types of tea, get exports from there to learn the ways of manufacturing different varieties of tea. And I think that is the order of the day. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gurung, for your wonderful insight into the tea manufacturing and the background of it. But obviously, we'll hear a little from Mr. Hoon when it comes to marketing, I think, a little apart from this image and perception, because I feel marketing is also a very important part, or most important part, because Sri Lanka is doing a wonderful job, if I'm not mistaken, and really speaking, in Dubai, where the real tea thing goes through, they have made an extremely different position for themselves. Anyway, thank you very much. And coming to Dr. Ravind Chakraborty. Dr. Chakraborty, as I mentioned, that transformation of the region cannot happen without the health. So health is something which in two aspects, one is the public health and one is health as a business. Obviously, because if we don't consider health as a business, the value or the value chain doesn't become complete. So we'd like to hear and have your valuable thought on that as far as North Bengal is concerned. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mohito. So, as we talk, do you think that we can also have some comments from the audience?
Yeah, we'll take it. I think once we are finish, over, right. we'll take sure. the...
So, anyway, still it's good morning. And it's wonderful to be here and to talk about North Bengal specifically regarding healthcare destination. So, as we all know that population-wise, Bengal has geographically three times more population than Maharashtra. And if you take North Bengal in isolation, the population is about 2 to 2.5 crore, which is again, that is a native population of North Bengal. Furthermore, as we discussed earlier, the North Bengal as compared to the other parts of Bengal is a different type of land, it's a mixed land. You got a agriculture-based flat land, to some extent industry, as well as there are a lot of hill areas where the other, the native populations, even the financial development, the growth are entirely different. So we, when we talk about healthcare, we need to consider North Bengal taking these points in together. We need to understand that despite a very wonderful, unique geography of Bengal, it's a very resourceful geography. It has, as we all discussed, got tea, got timber, and got tourism and fruits, for example, orange, even if you take Malda, mangoes. So it's a very resourceful population. And at the same time, very favorably connected, both nationally and internationally. Nationally in the sense very close to Sikkim, very close to Bihar, very close to Assam, and internationally because of Bangladesh, because of Bhutan. And healthcare should consider these entire geographical area. Because when we talk about doctors, when we talk about health, the interesting point of health and doctors is that we don't have any geography. Wherever I am, I'm a doctor. Right? I can, as you know, some of us are being registered worldwide, so we can practice. So that kind of differentiation we have, and similarly the patients are entirely the same. For example, I'll just share a small experience of mine. I went to Vietnam, the Ho Chi Minh city, and to a cath lab to do some procedures. And when the first time when I went in, and they said, there are a lot of patients, so why can't you change your scrub inside the airport? So inside the airport, I went to OT suits, and then took me in the car, went to the hospital, straight to cath lab. And then the first time, I did not realize that who is the patient, who is the doctor, who is the nurse, or who is the administrator. To me, they all look same. So then I said, my God, I have to do angioplasty in this group. So what am I going to do? Then I asked myself and realized that whatever may they look outside, inside the heart is the same, the coronary artery is the same, the valves are same. So okay, fine, so I'll do an angioplasty. Can I have the CD? They actually did angiography. They prepared the CDs. I went to the CD. I said, okay, this is... So then I realized that, well, I'm just in my own hospital. I started doing the procedures, and six cases I finished at a stretch, very complex cases. So that is the beauty of the healthcare. And when you talk about healthcare in North Bengal, Vishwajit, it is important that the geography is a little different. Beyond Malda and beyond, is actually the healthcare of North Bengal. It's not exactly the Siliguri, sort of areas around Siliguri. Even the people from Murshidabad should go up to North Bengal rather than come down to Kolkata. So strategically, we should think that when we talk about healthcare development, healthcare growth in North Bengal, we actually start talking about the land beyond Murshidabad and above. The problem is that in healthcare development, because I used to come to Siliguri, I'll tell you my short experience. I came back to India. I was a consultant cardiologist in the UK. I came back to India 21 years ago, and I came back to Hyderabad. I was at Hyderabad for a number of years, and then when I was at Hyderabad Apollo, I used to come to Siliguri to see patients. And those days, I saw that a lot of patients, and they actually started doing pacemaker implantation. They did not have any cath lab. So I was extremely proactive to talk to my colleagues over there to ensure that whether some cath lab can be brought in. So the people did not go to different places for emergency heart procedures. Eventually, cath lab came in. So there is a growth, but there is a growth in a very, very slow manner. This has to be enhanced. And then when I came to from Hyderabad to Kolkata, I was at Apollo Group of Hospital. And then also, there is some kind of growth, but I have to be very frank and honest. There is not much of growth or not enough growth that should have happened in 20 years' time, which is very unfortunate. And the reason is, which is very simple, I'm sure you all agree to that, and I would like to have comments from everybody, including the people on the floor, that the development of infrastructure. If you do not have enough infrastructure development, then the people, even the healthcare, the business people, the entrepreneurship, will not find it interesting or sort of very attractive to develop their healthcare sort of facilities in those areas. And the classical example is Midland. Let us say Midland like Durgapur did not have anything. The moment the highway came, and everything, the facilities improved, the infrastructure improved, immediately the healthcare system developed. Am I correct? So that is a classical example of how Durgapur developed. And in the same manner, if the North Bengal can be taken up by the administration, by the government, as well as by the chamber, and with such kind of discussion, I'm sure the healthcare can come up very importantly. As I said, that healthcare infrastructure-wise, we need to develop. And then we talk about health tourism. Now, it is easy to talk about health tourism, but what exactly is a health tourism? Health tourism is not that somebody is coming for a caesarean section. Health tourism is not that somebody is coming for a gallbladder operation. Health tourism, there is a nice article by Debashish Roy and I think Shogata Saha. And they wrote a very nice article saying that the medical tourism means, medical tourism is primarily composed of patients traveling overseas to receive tertiary care treatment in specialties like cardiology, like oncology, orthopedics, organ transplantation, cosmetic surgeries. These are the areas need to be focused when you talk about medical tourism. And for medical tourism, you need to have a good infrastructure development. Bishwajit has also already mentioned that the Baghdogra Airport. So clearly the Baghdogra Airport, I mean, it has changed. It definitely improved. I used to come to the other airport. Now it has improved. And the road has to improve. Because the time taken from, say, Siliguri to Kooch Bihar is probably far more than time taken from, say, Siliguri to coming to a different place down south. So that has to be developed. And at the same time, to have a healthcare development, you have to have other facilities. These are hospitality. Those facilities include so many things to develop hotel industries. These facilities also to develop the pickup point, the drop point, education system. So there are a lot of other areas need to be developed at the same time, then the healthcare can be improved. And it is extremely important. And I have to say, and I have to be very, very straightforward, that India has a remarkable growth in medical tourism. Remarkable. You will be amazed to hear that it has a potential growth, and it actually at the moment is nearly $3 billion business going on in India. And the targeted project by our government, especially the central government, is very focused to improve this medical tourism to $8 billion. But the problem is that this $8 billion with a targeted growth rate of 15.6%, and that is primarily focused towards northern part of India, which is Delhi, then southern part of India like Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad, and to some extent the western part of India like Mumbai and Ahmedabad. But Bengal also has got a potentiality. So we need to give a serious thought about that, how this target of 8 billion or beyond that, 10 billion, with a growth rate of 15.6 to maybe 20% can be achieved by incorporating Bengal in this kind of growth. And during this time, the North Bengal, because of a very strategic, politically, geopolitical location, and taking down from Murshidabad onward, I'm sure that this can be achieved. And the example is our Midland. Bengal Midland is growing, no doubt about that. Today, the patient from Raniganj, patient from Asansol, they actually get treated at Durgapur. So the same thing probably can be done. And finally, before I stop, the engagement of healthcare facilitator and other stakeholders are also important, like travel and tourism, travel to tourism organizers, hotelier, medical insurance companies, and respective embassies and consulates. Because since it's internationally connected, their offices also need to be developed. Visa processing has to be done, visa assistance, and development of guest houses, interpreter. For example, many people may come from other parts of other countries, so we need to have interpreters. And these services will be of extremely helpful if we take healthcare development in North Bengal in particular. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Chakraborty, for the wonderful deliberation and enlightening us of the possibilities of the healthcare revamping as well as, or transformation, I should put it, of North Bengal. Now, definitely, it's a long way to go. We have to start somewhere. And I feel maybe, you know, doers is one of the area we should really target, because that is amidst of the thing, you know, Bhutan and Bangladesh, it's an equidistant sort of a scenario. And obviously that, as you said, that Murshidabad, instead of going to, coming to Kolkata, it becomes always, what to say, more sensible to really go to a nearby place in North Bengal. So definitely we'll work together and we'll take it ahead. And I hope that things will change and we'll be able to transform the healthcare part of North Bengal. Now we'll come to Mr. Ashutosh Jaiswal. Mr. Jaiswal, with your experience and background, and recently you have come back from thing. So given the Northeast focus, you know, the gateway to Northeast and even Bangladesh and Bhutan, Nepal, logistics is a very, very important part. So obviously we'd like to hear from you about the possibilities and challenges as well of the logistics as far as North Bengal is concerned.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. In fact, it's very surprising that in 2021, it takes 18 hours to travel to Siliguri, almost a distance of 600 kilometers, and whereby we have national highways, which, you know, you can cover that distance in maybe maximum 10 hours, that is possible. See, for any business, it may be education, it may be health, it may be manufacturing, it may be trading, logistics has to be there, and a cost-effective logistics has to be there. The cost of logistics in our country, GDP basis, is around 17-18%, I've been hearing, for the last 10 years, and the government is intending to bring it down to 10%. So I had done a little bit of analysis that out of this 17%, what are the, breakup? So to my surprise, I found that 3-4% of that GDP logistic cost is inefficiency cost, which we are all bearing. That is inefficiency cost. How inefficiency? Because we don't have proper skilled people, we don't have proper infrastructure, we don't have proper load carrying policies. So for all these, we are bearing a cost of 3-4%. You imagine 3-4% of the GDP is we are paying the inefficiency cost. It's very, very alarming, number one. Number two is, for any logistic business, you must have that proper infrastructure. A proper infrastructure means the main national highway, the first mile connectivity has to be very, very strong, uniform and balanced. Second is the last mile connectivity, which is very, very bad in our country. You could travel across anywhere, you will find the last mile connectivity is very poor, which leads down to villages and to interiors. So the first mile and last mile connectivity, unless and until that is taken care of, the bringing down the logistic cost from 17-18% to 10% will be a really challenging task. Number three is, if you actually travel from Calcutta to Siliguri, you will find there are hubs. If I call, Murshidabad is a hub for mangoes and silk. And today that silk is almost eroding off. I mean, it was a silk which was appreciated world over. I mean, unfortunately, nothing has been done about it. Number two is the mango. I will give you a statistics of mango. Whatever we are selling, you forget about it. What is get damaged? That is more than 20% of whatever we are selling. 20% of the product is getting damaged and rotten. So can't we do anything about that? Number three is when you go a little up, we'll find that yes, there, you know, you have tea, you have jute, you have timber. And unfortunately, till now, it is very surprising, and I'm very happy also, on the other hand, that BCCI has taken up a very challenging task of upbringing North Bengal, and with a vision of our president. And I see that, yes, something really will be done. But you see, the entire logistics on the road, when we travel from here to Siliguri, there are single-way roads, there are two-way roads, some roads are still not complete. That's why it's taking 18 hours. It should have been completed in maximum 10 hours you could have completed. The cost of bringing in product from Malda to Calcutta is so high because of this highway only. That highway needs to have proper attention so that the cost can be brought down. Dr. Rabin Chakravarti was talking about amenities which are required to be developed simultaneously with healthcare, like hospitals, like restaurants and all. When you travel from here to Siliguri, you will hardly find an eating place in Krishnanagar. Before that, after that, you don't have a place to eat. So when you are traveling in Europe, every 50 kilometers you have a rest place and you have a eatery there. You can park your car, rest yourself, refill your car, have a nice food, relax and then drive again. But here from entire 600 kilometers, only Krishnanagar, we have one or two, three, you know, sort of a dhaba sort of a thing. And no organized eatery or rest place. When the government designs a highway, they should design simultaneously rest places, restrooms, and proper eateries out. All said and done, you know, you may have everything. You may have the proper infrastructure, you may have the proper logistics, you may have the proper education, you may have the proper tea, but I will really, really tell you, marketing and branding is extremely important. Unless and until you do that, your product will not be recognized. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to speak, and I hand over my mic to my next panelist. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jaiswal. It was wonderful, and what you said is right. At the end is right. That's why we have kept the Mr. Hoon's thing at the last. That is brand and branding and marketing. That will make all the difference actually to the region. But again, coming to infrastructure, putting it on a joking manner, Singur would not have happened if Durgapur Express was not there. Okay, so that important is infrastructure, especially road infrastructure. So now it's over to Mr. Hoon. So sir, we'd like to hear from you on the image and perception creation, and maybe having a lead to branding and marketing as far as the whole ecosystem is concerned.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Mr. Mohanty. I have an emotional connect as far as North Bengal is concerned. As a youngster living in Calcutta, there were two opportunities of holidays. So you either went to Puri or you went to Darjeeling, right? So you know, you had to actually convince your father that which was better to go to. So you got fed up of Puri and you went to Darjeeling. There used to be a Vicount flight. I think it was 1964, 65, I was in class 4 or 5. And as soon as you used to touch at Bagdogra, you actually moved into another world. Forget the look of the airport. Petite, small, lovely chicken cutlets you got in the restaurant there. And when you stepped out into a different green world. That environment absolutely captivated you. The drive to Darjeeling, right? Used to take about 3 hours, 10 minutes, 3 hours, 15 minutes. And you know, while you did it every alternate year, you never got tired of that. That beauty just got you. What really has happened is that a lot of things, I mean, you cannot say, it'll be very, very unfair to say that nothing has happened in North Bengal. That would be an incorrect statement. So let's look at, you know, 1984, and there is this industrial estate which is set up in Dabgram. Then you have the Siliguri industrial estate. Then you have an industrial estate coming in Falkata. You had tourism, which developed over a period of time. Tea, of course, had its glorious days. It still has a lot of gardens which have very good yield and record yield. In the Duars, outstanding, you know, gardens like Leash River, etc., who stand out completely as very good properties. But I think what has been really going on is that, you know, when you talk of transformation or change, the strategy of change is thought about at the upper levels, right? But change is a bottom-up process. There has to be engagement, right, of all agencies, of all businesses, of all associations, right, and the engagement of people. So you have to have a product. You know, unfortunately, there are so many things which are standalone efforts which took place at various points in time. There was no integrated effort which is there. And the effort to sell, I'm using the word sell, right, to people at the first level that indeed, right, this is heaven, North Bengal is heaven, and you have a great opportunity, right, which you must encash, right? I'm going to take two examples. The year is 2004-05. I went to drop my daughter to Germany. She was going to do her MS PhD in a place called Göttingen. So we landed up at Hanover, and you know, we were buying a ticket, and the slot machine, everything was written in German, right? And you know, I actually boarded a fast train, but I bought a ticket for a local, and you know, the gentleman was very polite, but he didn't speak English with me, right? So he told me I had to pay something more. My daughter was with me. And I come back to the same country just after the World Cup is over, the World Cup football. All the ticket conductors were speaking English, right? You could see signboards which were earlier only in German, right, with English legends at the bottom, right? That country understood that if you got to play host to an event like the World Cup, then you've got to get out of that obsession of everything German. You had to embrace the world. Each of the railway stations for all the major places had, you know, counters where there were English-speaking people, there were French people, there was Spanish, everything, right? So, you know, the kind of change that they brought about, right? And it was really training people, making people embrace that change and begin to live that change, right? It's not, it didn't end with the World Cup. You know, if you really see, right, a lot of accolades are given to Merkel for what she has achieved as far as the German economy, business, etc. is concerned. But I think that opening of the German mind of accepting the world is something which really took place at the time of the World Cup. Now, coming back to North Bengal, you know, whatever Dr. Chakravarti, Mr. Gurung, or Mr. Jaiswal are saying, until and unless you have a platform which actually has a blueprint, which has a 360-degree solution for all the stakeholders, all the businesses put together, and you have an agency which works to achieve that goal, are governments going to achieve that? The answer may be no. Experience has told us that governments are not capable of doing it. Because governments in India feel they can run airlines, they can run hotels, they can run healthcare, and what have you, and which they're not competent in doing. Please run the country and leave it to people with professional competence to implement transformation and change. You're not change experts, right? To create change champions, right? Who are industry or business specialists, who actually know how to implement that change at the ground level. So when you get off at NJP railway station or at Bagdogra airport, right, that cabbie behaves with you as if he is welcoming a personal guest home. That is what tourism is all about. See what happens when you go to a Singapore or when you go to Thailand, right? These countries have worked on it. Now, what kind of agency are we talking about? You know, when this effort, when Bishwajit was talking to me, and I told him, I said, you know something, as far as the Bengal Chamber is concerned, our objectives are very limited, right? And
absolutely focused as far as Bengal is concerned. For us, Bengal is paramount. Two, we are a non-profit organization, right? So making money is not really what we are into. You look at what industry and commerce need, and we are there to try and serve both industry and commerce. So you need an agency of this kind of sort, which is able to coordinate, which is able to create that blueprint, and therefore have a product. Once you have a product, then you can talk about marketing. Marketing without a product is meaningless. I mean, what are you saying? Are we saying, is it advertising? I remember seeing this West Bengal Tourism Board at Mathigada, at the corner, one lone board which says, welcome to the Doors, right? And is pointing towards the road to Darjeeling, right? So is that marketing, right? Because marketing is just not advertising. It's just not trying to communicate. But it is a composite effort of a good product, of people who are committed to excellence, people who are there to deliver, right? And that is what we try and do for all our customers. And then communicate that excellence or that commitment, right, to your customers, right? The opportunity as far as North Bengal is concerned, you know, whether it is the sustainable environment that you have, water resources, the amount of wastages which take place, whether you look at tourism, et cetera, you can just go on and on and on. Can we please stop ourselves? Can we get together, right? Get the people on the ground involved. Can you build an effort of change? And believe me, if you build that effort of change, marketing will be there to take over. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Hoon. Actually, it was a wonderful sort of a way of putting it, actually, how we should go about, because everything is not rosy. We have to really make a thought process and a strategy, because without a strategy, nothing really works out. Now, we'll end that session with this, and it was, I think, really enriching and wonderful from all of you. You know, that we have really made ourselves much richer in the way of really going ahead without this transformation. Definitely your thought processes we will be incorporating once we go ahead, and we will be really working together to do that. Thank you so much. So we end the session with that. I thank you once more. Yeah, actually, yeah, I think anything from all of you, because you know, you have, we had, I'm sorry, I missed it actually. So anybody wanting to know anything or ask anything? Mr. Kapoor, I think.
As you said, it's definitely a very enriching session which we had. I only want to, a very small thing, but I think it's very important that while we certainly want to promote tourism in the North Bengal, what we must promote along with it is responsible tourism, because otherwise we will destroy the very fragile ecosystem of that area. So I think we should always keep that in mind. Responsible tourism is what we need to promote. Thank you.
I think I need to add something to that. It's not only responsible tourism. You know, when you drive up to Darjeeling now, it's a horror, right? I'm sorry saying it like that. You know, the kind of urbanization which has taken place, even outside Siliguri, it's a mess. And you know, there is construction taking place, right? There is no planning which has been done. Everyone, you know, who can buy a plot of land is trying to exploit it. I think somewhere, right, a sense has to develop. You know, you're talking about restrooms and things like that. You leave Bagdogra Airport, and if you're traveling to Darjeeling, and if you've got a lady with you, there is no restroom on the way. Right? It's a horror. I mean, are you imagining that somebody doesn't need to use a restroom for three and a half, four hours? And if you are a tardy bit unlucky, right, by the time you hit Goom, you could take another hour and a half before you hit Darjeeling. But we're not concerned. How does it matter? Right? And we live in this whole world where we all congregate, we all talk.
But these elements are the ones which action needs to be taken, right? Very rightly, as Mr. Kapoor talked about, a very fragile environment. You know, if you look at all that has happened, you look at the city of Siliguri by itself. You know, I'm talking of 1976-77 when Sinclair's Hotel had just come out, and you know, you were at that junction. And that's where the city actually began from, right? And today you just look at what it has all become, and it's not planned. So I think, you know, when a person arrives in North Bengal, or when a person wants to do business with North Bengal, what he would like to see is a semblance of sense. He would like to see a semblance of discipline. He would see a commitment to your own environment. Those who live there inherited that beauty. Why are you ruining it? That means you have no heart for that place at all. So I think these are the elements which need to be brought, and people have to be made aware of them, right? And they have to begin to live that.
Yeah, please, please.
One quick comment from Mr. Hoon. I just to share my personal experience. Myself being a doctor, and I also am in the Executive Committee of Indian Medical Association, IMA, Physician API, Association of Physicians of India, as well as Cardiological Society of India. And also I'm the President-elect of Indian College of Cardiology. So by virtue of these positions, I try to do a little bit of medical conferences, and which I always do. And then I try to do it in North Bengal with the whole idea so the healthcare people around that region can also be aware of the specialties and also can participate actively so that they understand that particular geography. But I think at my capacity, I have done at least 5 or 6. Even at Kuchbihar, I did once. I still remember Kuchbihar I did, Malda I did, and Siliguri number of times. But despite all these, it hasn't really worked out. What is the reason, Mr. Hoon? I would like to have your input on that.
See, I am not governed by any code of conduct. So, you know, I can speak the truth. The issue is that in the corridors of power, there is no intention. Simple as all that. And if I look at my own state, right, I'm so proud to be a person from Bengal. But I look back at those times in the 60s when the streets were washed, when my relatives from parts of the country said, you know, Calcutta's got the best nightlife, it's got the best restaurants, wow, what a place to come to, right? And then one fine morning we got up. We took a gun in our hands, we looked at our 2 feet and we began to shoot. And we collapsed. We weren't happy. We got up again, nursed ourselves, stood up again, took a gun and shot ourselves again. And we've done it 34 times. And we still haven't stopped. I think would that answer? There is no intent. You know, at the end of the day, the corridors of power have to display intent. You know, sir, you've had these conferences. I'm sure that the doctors who came to attend these conferences came with a good heart. They would like to go and do things, but, you know, if you run into a wall, if you find barriers, right, you say, well, let me do my own business and forget it all on the side. And that's what exactly keeps happening. All of us keep doing what we think is good for ourselves. Because somewhere along the line, you say, no, enough is enough. I don't think I'm going to involve myself anymore. So there is a degree of frustration, a degree of annoyance, right? And disengagement which takes place. And then you say, fair, this is what it is all about. I'm sorry.
Thank you so much. I think, yeah, one more question is there.
So I'm a brief introduction. I'm Major General Sapra, retired. And presently, I am the director of Army Institute of Management at Newtown. I've been in Kolkata for almost 1.5 years. My compliments for the contemporary topic which has been chosen. I would not contest the desirability of the prescription or the recipe prescribed by any of the panelists or the subject matter experts. We have known it all along. What probably you've been saying ails North Bengal, also ails most parts of India. So while we have known it all along, what's holding us back for putting our act together for the last 70 odd years? Is it a governance issue? Is it a leadership issue? Or is it just the Indian way of doing things? You know, the chalta hai, you know, ethos. Yes, Mr. Hoon covered it to a large extent. Being brought up in an army household, I have been fortunate to visit North Bengal in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and even recently, as recently as last year. And what one has seen is, you know, a steady decline. I mean, a march down a precipice, which no one is willing collectively, you know, to arrest. There are large number of chintan baithaks which happen, right? Soul searching which happens. But somewhere when it comes to action, we falter. The very fact that you're talking of transformation and you're not talking about change is because over the last 70 years, there is a sense of guilt that we have failed our present generations in maybe realizing the potential of our country or our region or our place, whatever way you look at it. So what exactly do you think in, you know, needs to be done? I'm sure a vision plan would be coming up in due course. What I would probably recommend is not to make a career out of just about fault finding as to what ails the system and pointing the finger outwards, but making a career out of solutions. Since we have missed the small incremental changes which should have been made over the last 70 years, maybe hence there is a need for transformation now. And in any way in which you think the Army Institute of Management can help to undertake any study to put things on track, it'll be a pleasure to do that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Can I just finish? Just. Thank you so much for your this question, actually. See, what is happening is, as far as this committee is concerned and what deliberations we had, we will definitely make a beginning somewhere. And we will be really happy to get to you also to see that your thoughts and thing, you know, we'll try to integrate that. But obviously, it's a very complex process because, you know, I can put it in one word, you know, 70, 80 years back, Singapore wanted to become Kolkata. Okay, they have become Kolkata of then. But we have become what we really don't know. So we have to really get back to the thought process. Thank you. I think, should we close with that?
Last question.
Yeah.
This is to Dr. Chakravarti. So you have mentioned about the various health programs that are possible. Just a thought that as we make this process go on, how does your scheme work in a place like Darjeeling, where it infiltrates right down to the village? Because how does that message go across that there is a medical facility available? North Point is doing something where they are taking mobile ambulances to the gardens. So this is a very important thing that need to be considered for how do you take the medical healthcare services right up down to the gardens.
Yeah, I think that's very excellent. In fact, we made such attempt. What we do normally, when we do medical conferences, we invite the doctors from the local areas, like Darjeeling and Kuch Bihar, Dinajpur, Balurghat, we call them. And especially in an API meeting, Physician of India meeting, and IME meeting, there's a good gathering. And one day is being dedicated for such training that, you know, you have to go to very basic level of primary healthcare, and we talk about it, and how it can be delivered. Even we call a paramedical team, we call nurses, the full dedicated thing. And we repeatedly do that, ensure that this is being continued. But unfortunately, I think all of us mentioned that, you know, just few doctors and few team cannot do it. We need to have other facilities, facilitator, for example, to be together to ensure that the process or the theme which has been propagated in the conference can be continued for a longer period of time. Unfortunately, that could not be done. In fact, one of the meetings, we had our central Minister of State of Health, and despite that, it just could not, because there was nobody to take it further down, which was probably touched upon by others. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So we'll close on that, and please.
You know, there's a very good model which is there. If you look at Delhi today, the Mohalla clinics, as you, I'm sure you heard about the Mohalla clinics with the government of Delhi put in, and you know, I mean, they go down to the level of covering about 4,000 to 5,000 people as an area, right?
And there are days which are fixed in the week when the Mohalla Clinic is held, right? These are very primary healthcare facilities which are put across. But the regularity which is done and the commitment which the government of Delhi has displayed towards them, and that is really getting healthcare to the doorstep of all concerned and to the poorest of the poor. And that is important because they are the ones who need it most, right? The others who might be able to afford it, might be able to travel, might be able to move. So that's an excellent model, right? And you know, to talk about 1100 Mohalla clinics being held, I think is an exemplary model to follow.
As a health committee initiative, we have started a primary healthcare facility facilitation for non-communicable diseases, which is about to start from Sundarban area. You are here as the chairman of North Bengal committee, and Dr. Chakraborty is also here. He is the chairman of our health committee. If you can incorporate this facility, this primary healthcare for non-communicable diseases in rural areas, not only in the southern Bengal, we are here also to work in North Bengal area. Just for your information, as both of you are here.
Excellent, this is excellent. NCD, this is called NCD program of central government. The NCD non-communicable disease program is extremely important. Delighted to hear that. And I'm sure we should also actively participate from our health committee of Bengal Chamber of Commerce.
Dr. Chakraborty, what he mentioned, I think this is a very important part for us also. I've been talking to President also. We have been telling that we will integrate the inter-strengths of the committees, you know, to take, because North Bengal is the only regional committee of the Bengal Chamber. So obviously we will take the strengths and maybe we can start with this. It was a wonderful suggestion.
And one more thing. I'm a diabetologist. When I do not see patients, I travel. I have a home also in Duars.
Okay, wonderful.
From my personal experience, I can tell you, I have many friends in tea garden circuit. In most of the tea gardens, there are no qualified doctors. Quacks are there, so-called registered medical practitioners. And those people are very superstitious people. As Mr. Gurung is here, so if you can incorporate that education committee or something like that.
Health education, very much.
To allay the superstitions regarding different diseases. Like these things. I think this will be of much help for fostering a good health situation in that area.
Yeah, one part actually, which I have not mentioned, this that in our committee we have decided to have activities of such sort, which will be having connect with the communities and the culture also. I think we'll end at that because we'll move to the next session. Thank you.
A special note of thanks to our esteemed panelists and Mr. Mohinta for moderating the wonderful session. I would request Mr. Mohinta to kindly stay back on stage, please, to moderate the next session as well. We will now begin with the second session, the importance of integrating North Bengal with Northeast growth ecosystem. We are delighted to have Sri Tathagata Roy amidst us here today. We thank you, sir, for taking out time from your busy schedule and gracing the occasion. I would now request Mr. Biswajit Mohinta, the chairperson of the North Bengal committee, to formally welcome Sri Tathagata Roy with a flower bouquet. Sir, may we have you on stage, please? Sri Tathagata Roy served as the Honorable Governor of Tripura from 2015 to 2018 and the Honorable Governor of Meghalaya from August 2018 to the end of his term in August 2020. He joined the Bharatiya Janata Party in 1990 and was the sixth president of West Bengal State Unit of Bharatiya Janata Party from 2002 to 2006 and a member of the BJP National Executive from 2002 until 2015. Sri Roy briefly had an additional charge of the office of the Honorable Governor of Arunachal Pradesh from July 2016 till August 2016. He had a distinguished academic career, having been ranked sixth in the higher secondary examination as a student of St. Lawrence High School, Kolkata, and a recipient of the Jagadish Bose National Science Talent Research Scholarship. A civil engineer by training, he was employed with the Indian Railways and later taught at Jadavpur University as a professor of construction engineering and the founder head of the department. He was also awarded the Distinguished Alumni Award by the Indian Institute of Engineering Science and Technology, Shibpur, in March 2016. Shri Roy has written and published extensively, both in English and in his native Bengali, on subjects of social and political importance. So we begin with the session. Thank you.
I take this opportunity to welcome respected and honorable Sri Tathagata Rai. And really speaking, it has been my personally also a wonderful moment for me to have him with us today. But again, I said that initially, because of certain restrictions of the thing, we couldn't have him on stage initially at the beginning of the program. Now, sir, only we will start on the subject, that is integrating North Bengal with the Northeast ecosystem, which is very important. Because without that, the growth of the whole region, including North Bengal, is incomplete. And I think you will agree very much with me on that, or to really take ahead North Bengal, there has to be integration being the gateway to Northeast. I will just put two of my thoughts on that, you know, two instances. As I mentioned initially that we have, the Bengal Chamber of Commerce has started the Northeast Committee also. Incidentally, I'm chairing that too. We are just in the formation stage of that. And this has started because of my experience from Tripura. Because I mentioned to you also that I've been working with Tripura and the government has been very supportive. We are doing a lot of activities there. At my personal level, as an entrepreneur, as an industry strategist, as well as from the chamber also, we are trying to put in a lot of things together. Now, one experience what we had recently, that is a place called Sabroom. Sabroom is absolutely the end of India touching Chittagong. Now, Chittagong is again known as the Mumbai of Bangladesh, because that is the hub of commercial activities actually for Bangladesh. Now, it is only 70 kilometers from Chittagong, whereas it is 140 kilometers from Agartala. Now, it's absolutely a remote place where I have seen the enthusiasm, because I was invited first there only to really support the activities, because Government of India is coming up with a special economic zone. They have made a huge investment there. And really, it's a total transformation process, what I was wanting to put forth. Recently, two teams have gone. Dr. Chakraborty had initiated that one from Medica Hospital and one from AMRI Kolkata, to find the possibility of setting up a hospital chain and maybe a small health hub sort of a thing there. So really speaking, this has evoked a lot of enthusiasm amongst our North Bengal team also, that why not to have something in North Bengal and such integration process. This is one. Second thing is, if I recall back around a couple of years back in Infocom, where you are one of the speakers in Kolkata, and that time you were the governor of Meghalaya, and you had the director of Meghalaya Tourism. And it was, I think, the most wonderful experience about tourism and what tourism can be and how tourism can be branded. So these are the learning processes. So by integration, what we mean is not only integrating the policies or activities, it is the integrating the thought process. So sir, I'll come to you with that, and we will like to hear from you of your valuable means or ways for us to go ahead as far as this integration process is concerned. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mohinta. Honorable audience, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak at this very august forum, the oldest chamber of commerce of this region, and I believe the second oldest in the world. Am I right? Second oldest in the world. The idea of integrating the Northeast with the North Bengal with the ecosystem of the Northeast, it sounds very grand, but at the bottom line, it translates into development of North Bengal. Unless North Bengal is developed, it cannot integrate anywhere else. In fact, its development in terms of logistics and infrastructure is so inadequate that it is behind most states of Northeast India. And therefore, the question of its integration can arise only after that development is there. Now, this is a little strange because this government, the central government, is following a policy of look east and act east. And in spite of that, we find that North Bengal lies undeveloped. And what is the reason? The reason has been hinted by Mr. Hoon a little while back. First of all, let me make it clear that although I belong to a political party, I am not representing the political party. I am not here as a representative of any political party, mine or any other, simply as an individual. Therefore, I am also not bound by any code of conduct. So having said that, what Mr. Hoon said was right. There is no intent. There is no intent to improve things. There is no intent to develop North Bengal. In order to have an intent, one must have a vision. One must know what one intends. I intend to pick up this pen. So therefore, I see a pen, I pick it up. But if I don't know what a pen is or where it is lying, then my intent will, wanting will not transform itself into an intent, and intent without intent, certainly it will not transform itself into an action. The intent, in order to analyze it, I have to get into the dangerous quagmire of politics, but it is inevitable. So far, for very many years, we have had a sort of povertarian politics in West Bengal, which has resulted in the flight of industries from the state. If you take a look at the companies which were members of this Chamber of Commerce in the year 19, the early 60s, and today, you will get a very clear idea of what we have come through, how far we have immersed ourselves in this morass. When I was in college, I entered college in 1961 after passing higher secondary. And when I was in college, this place used to be the hub of industries. Right next to our college, there was the giant Gaskin-Williams factory. There was a small structural engineers factory called A.N.J. Main. There was Port Engineering Works. A little further ahead, there was Remington Rand. All these companies were there. If we move around Kolkata, on the way to the airport, there was Gestetner. Then very near to my house, there was Jai Engineering Works. All of them have fled. All of them have fled because the intent was wrong. Either there was no intent or the intent was wrong. The intent was to keep people in a state of poverty, in a state of gentle poverty, so that they had to run to the political authority to get their problem solved, and the political authority threw them crumbs, and the people would be satisfied with those crumbs. With these things, many of you are professional managers here, you would be familiar with what is known as the Maslow's pyramid. Maslow's pyramid, that is, which defines the hierarchy of needs, that human beings have different levels of needs. A lower order need must be satisfied before a higher order need can arise. And the intent has been, I must express my gratefulness to Mr. Hoon. I think he has left. But he mentioned that very important word, intent. The intent was to keep people tied to the lower order needs like physiological needs and safety needs. But this is not a forum to discuss general politics or management. So therefore, let me come back to North Bengal. See, North Bengal, one problem has been that it is far away from Kolkata. Now, West Bengal is a very peculiar state where all development, all thinking, all brains, all everything is centered in one single city. And the rest of the state is just a rural slum. If you look at any other state, say for instance, a state like Jharkhand, even Jharkhand has two comparable cities, Ranchi and Jamshedpur. If you look at a more advanced or developed state like Maharashtra, it has Mumbai, it has Nagpur, it has Pune, it has Solapur, it has Ichalkaranji, a lot of places. Gujarat has Ahmedabad, Gujarat has Surat, Gujarat has Baroda, Gujarat has Rajkot. But here everybody, all development, all brains, all efforts, all know-how, everything is concentrated here, and because North Bengal is too far away, that is why North Bengal, one, that is very important reason why North Bengal has not developed. So what we need to do is to develop a counter, first of all, according to my thinking, we need to develop a counter magnet in North Bengal. The town of Siliguri has excellent potential, fantastic potential. I don't know how many of us realize it, but it is possibly the only city in the whole world which has four international borders within 100 kilometers. Nepal, Bhutan, China, and Bangladesh. Nathula, I don't think, would be more than 100 kilometers away from Siliguri, and that is the farthest border. The rest of the borders are very close. So with that kind of location, any place would have given rise to a very nice, good, planned city. Unfortunately, that has not happened. A little while back, I think it was Mr. Hoon again who was mentioning how Siliguri has developed. It has developed like mushroom. The way Kipling had described Calcutta back in the British days, chance erected, chance directed. Siliguri has grown up just like that. A city which is growing like that without the slightest thought being given to town planning of a city is unthinkable anywhere else, but it is quite thinkable in West Bengal because we have povertarian governments. Governments which take pride in poverty, governments which take pride in being poor, when people who are being told to be poor or poverty is a desirable state of affairs. Now this is something that I have found all my life very revolting. Poor people may be respectable, just as rich people may be respectable, but poverty under any circumstances can't be a desired state of affairs, desired state in which a person wants to be. Yet, that is what has been taught. It is still taught to little children in this state. So as a result of which, it has gone deep into their DNA that to be rich is foul and to be poor is glorious. Quite opposite to what Deng Xiaoping had said when he took China on the path of progress, that to be rich is glorious. Anyway, I'm digressing. Let me come back to North Bengal again. So we need urbanization and we need a proper planned city next to Siliguri. This is fundamental. One single Uttarkonda or one single North Bengal University or medical college is not going to make a difference. We need a city. We need a city which can draw people away from Kolkata, from the rest of the state, and bring it there. That city will need an airport. Bagdogra Airport is certainly not sufficient. Bagdogra is an airport which is shared by civil aircrafts together with the Air Force, as a result of which, during certain hours, there is no civil no movement of civil aviation. Now, that is absolutely not acceptable. It has to be this way. It has to be an exclusive civil airport, just like most other airports are. Small airports like the Silchar, for instance. Silchar is shared between the Air Force and the civil aviation. Even Agartala is not shared. Silchar is shared. But Bagdogra is too important to be shared that way. North Bengal definitely needs a separate airport. Then the different hubs of transport, they've got to be integrated. Between New Jalpaiguri station, railway station, bus terminal, and the new airport, there has to be some kind of transport arrangement. The roads connecting North Bengal have already been spoken about by my previous speakers. The roads are horrible. Some places they are just two lanes, some places they are four lanes, they are not even properly marked, so that you suddenly find that you are in a two-lane situation from a four-lane situation, and then you get into a situation where accidents can take place. The roads are not properly, the geometrics are also not properly planned. And there is something to which I shall draw your attention, for which I need a map, but this map is quite sufficient. Do you see this little bit of Bangladesh over here? This is called Tetulia. This place is called Tetulia. Tetulia is in Bangladesh. Now, if we build a viaduct across that little bit of Bangladesh without touching Bangladesh physically, but going over it and naturally paying royalty or entering into a treaty or doing whatever, we can shorten the distance between Islampur and Jalpaiguri to the extent of, I think, 80 kilometers, no less than that. That is an enormous saving. Actually, I had tried to broach this idea to our external affairs minister, Srimati Sushma Swaraj, when she was in that post. But she took some initial interest, although she said that the Bangladesh government is rather lukewarm about it, and they had mentioned it at some point of time, but it didn't progress further. After that, Sushmaji fell ill, and then after that, she succumbed to her illness. So the matter did not progress. But this is something that I think the chamber, the North Bengal adjunct of that of this chamber, can actively take up with the external affairs ministry. Bangladesh is extremely important for North Bengal, and it has got to be, this importance has got to be understood. Until about 15-20 years back, the border wasn't even fenced. You can see the look of the border. It is a very indented border, very irregular border. One very good thing that has been done since 2014 is that there were enclaves. Enclaves were islands of Bangladeshi territory in India or Indian territory in Bangladesh. These are something that are unknown in any other part of the world. These enclaves have been exchanged between India and Bangladesh, with the result that we don't have the... You would be surprised to know that there was an enclave of Bangladesh inside India, and inside that enclave there was another enclave which was India within that enclave. Unthinkable thing. And you can imagine the state of the civic services, health services that those people were having. But in spite of all these things, these problems have been finally given a go-by through that treaty, and the enclaves have been exchanged, and at least one problem is gone. Fencing is also largely done. Fencing is very important to prevent cattle thefts. and the safety of the people, because a lot of dacoits used to come from Bangladesh and steal Indian cattle. Indian cattle is in great demand in Bangladesh, and the fencing was absolutely necessary. It has been delayed ever since independence for so many years. Now the fencing is more or less through. What else do we need by way of infrastructure? Infrastructure is the key to development of North Bengal. It's a key to development of any place, any other place, but to the development of North Bengal. We need 4-lane roads right through. Possibly we need 6-lane, but the requirement of the traffic has to be carefully measured, and thereafter it has to be decided whether it must be 4-lane or 6-lane. And this will also require construction of or expansion of the bridge across the Ganga River at Farakka. Farakka, right now we have a 2-lane bridge running across the barrage. That is not enough. That very often gives rise to jams, and as a result of that jams, people are delayed. So we need that sort of thing. We also need bypasses for the towns of Malda, possibly Islampur, quite a few others. Siliguri does have a bypass. Without that, would have been unthinkable. But even that is not quite satisfactory. If this viaduct across the Tetulia corridor is built, then that would make things a lot better. Now, coming back to the other aspects of development, the three T's of North Bengal, that is tourism, tea and timber, have already been mentioned, and all have been deliberated over by the previous speakers. So I will not repeat what they had spoken about. Urbanization is a point that I have already mentioned. One thing that is possible to be developed to a very great extent in North Bengal and which can bring a lot of wealth to the region is hydropower. North Bengal has a large number of rivers which flow from Bhutan into North Bengal and then further on to Bangladesh. And these rivers have quite a lot of hydel potential. Out of them, I think only Tista has been harnessed to some extent. And Torsha, which is known as by some other name in Bhutan, it is Bhutan has built a hydel power station in a place called Chukha, which I have visited, from where they produce a lot of electricity. But there is scope for harnessing. I think Joldhaka also has a hydel power station, but it is not running very satisfactorily. All the other rivers, the large number of rivers which flow from Bhutan into India, into Bangladesh, like Mohananda, then Joldhaka and Tista, I have already mentioned, then Leash, Ghish, the Shankosh, Raidak, all of them, these have hydel potentials. These hydel potential need to be developed. Food processing is another aspect which has been touched upon by the previous panel. Excuse me. Sorry. Food processing is a thing which has been touched upon by the previous panel. When I was governor of Tripura, I had taken great interest in food processing, because Tripura had certain crops which were very amenable to processing. One was pineapple. Tripura has very, very excellent, delectable species of pineapple called queen pineapple. Those of who have tasted it would know how sweet they are. It is one of the best fruits that I have tasted all over the world. But it is not canned. It is not branded, and it is not marketed or showcased. as a result of which most of the crop goes waste, the farmers don't get much. Another, finally, before I conclude, I must mention that North Bengal, in spite of very much being a part of the northeastern ecosystem, whether we like it or not, whether it is satisfactory or not, it is a part of the northeastern ecosystem. In fact, from the rest of the northeast to Sikkim, which is part of the northeast, you can pass only through North Bengal. So why North Bengal is not considered a part of the northeast, and given the incentives that are given by the donor ministry to the northeastern states, that is a bit of an enigma to me. The West Bengal government should have been active in trying to get this privilege for North Bengal, but there again, there is the problem of intent and vision, which I had mentioned a little while back. I don't want to dwell further on it because of obvious reasons, but it ought to be done. This part of North Bengal, if it is included in the Northeast, it is not necessary to include the rest of the state of West Bengal, but North Bengal, the part of Bengal north of the Ganga River, it is an essential part of Northeast, and it ought to be given the incentives that are available to the rest of the Northeast. That is more or less what I had to say. Now, you might very well complain that I have not really touched upon the subject, that is, how to integrate it with the northeastern states or ecosystem of the northeastern states. But it is my thesis, or it is my submission before this august body, that development must precede any kind of integration. If a region is not developed, it cannot be integrated. Therefore, let us look at the development, specifically the development of the integration, the infrastructure, that only will make integration possible. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, sir. Actually, this is a big learning for us, absolutely, because development has to be at par, then only integration is possible. Because the benchmark level what Northeast has reached is, I think, really speaking, which personally I've witnessed for last few years, it's much, much beyond North Bengal. So obviously, sir, what you rightly said, we have to be at par first, then we can integrate. So we'll take this as a lesson, and definitely we'll make effort to do that. And so thank you once more to be part of us today and sharing your thoughts, most valuable thoughts with us, actually. Thank you, sir. Any questions from the thing?
Audience? Questions, observations, comments? Yes, please.
My name is Suparna Datta Gupta. I am from the Committee of Exhibitions and Business Promotion. Right now, throughout the day, we have heard about the three T's, out of which two T's are at total contrast with each other. One is the industry of timber, and the other one is the industry of tourism. So how can that balance be drawn? Because if there is such a lot of logging taking place, is there a system to replenish those trees that are being logged? At the same time, we are talking about development, about industry, etc., infrastructure. So where can we draw a balance? Please suggest.
See, I am not a botanist, or I don't have any sort of in-depth knowledge or experience in forestry. But I believe that in forestry there is a norm that for every tree that you cut, you have to plant a certain number of trees. And as long as whenever trees are cut from reserve forests, The Forest Department has control on them, and this replanting of trees goes on with it. Where it has not gone on, the forests have suffered horribly. That we have seen in different parts of India. Myanmar, which was once upon a time the supplier of most of the very superior teak of this region. In fact, in this building itself, I'm sure you'll find a lot of Burma teak being used, particularly the doors behind you or on this side. But Burma teak is not easily available from Burma, even forgetting the problems of inter-country transfer. It is not very easily available because there has been logging going on indiscriminately. As opposed to that, Malaysia has taken much better care of it. So we can learn from countries like Malaysia. And if we observe the norms of replanting, which I am sure we have in this country also, then I think the matter of timber and the matter of environment, they can be adequately balanced.
Thank you. We'll close at that. And Madam, what question you asked, there's a session on environment. I think maybe we can have a look at that in this question. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir. Thank you. We'll end at that.
We will now begin with the third session, the emotional quotient factor towards revival of the past glory of tea and tourism in Darjeeling Hills. To address us in this session, we would now like to welcome Mr. Ravi Thapa, former VP, Manjushri Plantations. I would request Mr. Thapa to kindly take his seat on the stage. A graduate in economics from St. Joseph's College, Mr. Thapa did his schooling from North Point, Darjeeling. He did his BBA in marketing on an exchange scholarship program from the University of Montana. He has over 45 years of experience in the tea industry, having joined J. Thomas & Company Private Limited as a tea taster in Kolkata in 1974. Mr. Thapa was actively involved in helping producer companies to extend marketing of bulk tea into value-added form, particularly at Williamson Mega. As a Nestle vending franchisee, he opened his first cafe, Nescafe in India, as an out-of-home, ready-to-drink beverage outlet in Pune in 2000. Subsequently, he assisted management to create and operate the Tea Place by Manjushri, an upmarket tea outlet in Kolkata for Manjushri Plantations Limited, a BK Birla Group company. He is actively involved in helping provide opportunities to youth, particularly those with limited resources and in distant places like tea estates, in identifying interest and latent talent, which will help them stand on their own feet. I would now request Mr. Deb A. Mukherjee, President, the Bengal Chamber, to welcome Mr. Thapa with a flower bouquet.
Deep pleasure
to come. Over to you, sir. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon to all. Thank you very much for this opportunity to have to be able to address an august gathering such as this. It is indeed, I'm reading out some of this because it's taken me a long time to write this. So I'll keep it short. It is indeed a privilege, an honor, and a pleasure to have been invited to address this august gathering. I'm grateful to the North Bengal Committee of the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry for having given me this opportunity. Today, I have been asked to share my thoughts on the emotional quotient factor towards revival of past glory of tea and tourism in Darjeeling. It's a huge topic and it's more subjective. I will just share basically my own experience of Darjeeling and the memories I have had of Darjeeling that makes me feel that there is a lot that can be done in Darjeeling by using the local talent that is available and the local resources. I have spent the best years of my youth in Darjeeling while at North Point School and College, subsequently visiting tea estates in Darjeeling during my training days as a tea taster, as mentioned earlier. And also as a tourist, I have visited Darjeeling in different stages in my life, and I have found that the feeling of camaraderie that used to exist, that happy, smiling faces, is there inherently in every person in Darjeeling. It just needs to be allowed to be, basically break free. I treasure those wonderful days of seeing everybody happy, smiling, exchanging greetings, and sharing the camaraderie of a large, large family. The Dajus freewheeling their old Austin taxis, shopkeepers exchanging stories while trading their products, teachers rushing to respective teaching assignments, porters going up and down the mountainside carrying heavy loads, and tourists strolling around, marveling at the friendly nature of the people while admiring the scenic beauty of the Himalayan range. Amidst all this was the aroma of momos, thuppa, and exotic edibles, and of course, tea shops selling teas from the many tea gardens around the town. And all these activities would come to an end if there was an important football match at the North Point ground. People would stop working, taxis would all move towards Singamari, and there was to be a lot of post-match discussion, debates about every game or about every player. The reason I mention this is because football is the DNA of Darjeeling. As a consequence of this bonhomie, this joyful environment where the emotional quotient factor was high, tourism flourished, pleasant relationships at all work stations, particularly at the tea estates, resulted in productive, efficient, and remunerative returns. Socio-economic conditions were positive. The josh was high. People were happy. These were the glorious days, the glorious times at Darjeeling. However, in the mid-80s, when the factors beyond control, such as the collapse of a large export market for Darjeeling tea due to the disintegration of the erstwhile USSR, affected revenues of tea plantations. This, coupled with changing ownership and managements, led to problems at many tea estates. Labor unrest at the tea estates affected lives of a large number of people. Resultantly, an air of uncertainty prevailed, and several negative forces were at play in the Darjeeling Hills. Consequently, tourism suffered as much as tea, the two major revenue earners of Darjeeling. However, as everything in life, what goes down must come up. I strongly believe that the strong emotional factor of the local people of Darjeeling, particularly the youth, with their ability to adapt to changing circumstances, their self-confidence, their self-belief, and taking the initiative to move forward, has revitalized their energies. The present generation, along with the older people who are there to guide them, has shown an urgency to want to change. And I think this is important for any kind of change that is possible. Over the last 10 days since I was informed of this particular conclave, I have been in touch with a lot of local people, a lot of Darjeelingers, as I would call them, and many local boys and girls, alumni of different educational institutions, including the founder principal of a prominent school whose logo is out there, Himali, sports, especially football enthusiasts, and professionals from the tourism and tea industry have conveyed their interest in this endeavor to revive the past glory of Darjeeling. I also believe that with support from like-minded people, both within Darjeeling and those who wish Darjeeling well and who share the same feeling, can and will bring to fruition our dreams through collective effort of reviving the glorious past of Darjeeling. A lot of this I am reading out, but it comes from what I feel about Darjeeling. And I do believe that given an opportunity in the pillars, the four pillars that I feel are important are tea, tourism, and education, as was mentioned earlier, and as importantly, football. The reason football has a very special role to play in Darjeeling is because that till today brings people together. It has combined whenever there is a match or there is any kind of match at any ground, the paucity is the ground. And in these occasions, there are people, there are youth, there are old people who all mingle very freely. And this is really an opportunity for them to exchange ideas, to exchange thoughts, the older people to advise the younger people to get direction from the older people, because that is a time when their defenses are down, they're all very receptive. And this is a medium which continues to bring people from all walks of life together. A tea garden worker, a traffic cop, a porter, a nurse, a social worker, a shopkeeper, towards building camaraderie. As I mentioned earlier, it is in the DNA of Darjeeling. Therefore, it's a popular connector of people. I also mentioned that in order for us to bring about a change, the first factor would be really the tea estates, in the sense the worker needs to be recognized, the local man needs to be recognized, and if he's given an opportunity to work, and I did not want to really delve in the subject of the more serious governmental issues or trade issues, but I do believe that if I, as a person in Darjeeling, in a tea garden, am given a roof over my head, clothes to wear, food to eat, a provision where I can educate my children, I would be more than willing to go out and work. And I would be given an opportunity to actually, even if it is plucking, which has been told, or as we see, there is difficult to find pluckers in today's day and age. Maybe my grandmother did it, my mother did it, my sister did it, but today we can resume that activity, provide I'm given the wherewithal to be able to provide for my sustenance. And of course, I personally feel that in every ground, on every tea garden, there is always a little bit of land. And that land, at every place in a small garden, there must necessarily be a portion kept aside for a ground, for a school, for possible a hospital, so that the people feel that they are cared for. Today, a lot of, sad to say, ownerships have changed. Ownership remains at the top level. As was mentioned earlier by one of the speakers, the system has to change from not top down, but from bottom up. And if there is a concern shown to the local people down the line, I'm sure there are others who would also believe that we can bring about a change. If the gardens begin to show some result, if they are working as they are expected to do and as they used to earlier, there will be better looking gardens, there will be a product that, as was mentioned earlier, that we can sell, that we can market, and this will spread around the town, it will spread some goodwill. And if the gardens are looking as lush as they were earlier, automatically the environment will change, tourists will start coming in like it used to. And I think that this is very necessary for somewhere it has to begin. And the local people I consider myself very much local, even though I have only spent most of the time outside now. But I feel that there have been a lot of promises made. It's this forum or this platform will enable us to come to some definite structure or program by which we can tell them that we are not only talking, we are doing. If we can help turn one garden around, if we can help a resort, there are a lot of local people who are trying to run independent tourist setups by encouraging tourists to go to villages, to these garden resorts. I think that needs, the local people need a little bit of boost. And again, I personally feel that there is so much of talent in Darjeeling. There is education, literacy rate is high, and people have the energy. If vocational training is given at institutions, at the colleges, at the schools in Darjeeling, if they are taught into fields like what is tea all about, given them training into internships at the gardens, at blending, at tasting, and into the various tea marketing activities, similarly into hospitality, into tourism, and this, therefore, education becomes a very important factor in giving them, making them local people believe that they are also capable of learning. They can become teachers, they can become consultants, they can become professionally, they can be professionally knowledgeable to be able to take it into their own hands, to be able to market their own teas, to talk about Darjeeling to people outside. And I think that element of local involvement, as was mentioned early, has to come about to enable us to get back to what was Darjeeling before. There are a lot of our Darjeeling people who have gone out, who have got educated, who have gone out for education. However, this period of COVID might be a good time when we can give the local people an assurance that we are ready for a change. They can come back and they can teach those who are there locally and say that, okay, we have been out. Let us come and do our own thing for our own people. This is our land. Where will we go? If we can do it ourselves, I think we'd be better off. We are self-dependent. We are self-sustaining. And I think that is really the call of today, that platforms such as this, we've heard our eminent speaker just talk about integration, how we can learn from what others are doing. And I think our youth is ready to learn. I think that we are all tired of moving about without any direction. It is up to us who have been lived our lives to be able to share our experiences, to teach our people, whether it is tea, whether it is tourism. And we have some experts in football who are willing to come and teach football to our youngsters in Darjeeling. There is latent talent. It is happening in the Northeast. Our youngsters, boys and girls, are naturally tough. We play at high altitudes. And there is talent and there is skill. We can possibly promote ourselves as a hub of sports, a hub of football, because not everybody is maybe into academics or into vocational or becoming engineers or doctors, but a very large proportion of our youngsters today are into football. And as I mentioned earlier, if you have a football match happening even in Pul Bazaar, which is miles down from the town, people will be there. And of late, I heard last week that there was a football match organized by the Ghum Hill Schools. And they have a local tournament. And there were 20,000 people who came from all over to watch that game. They encouraged people to set up momo stalls. And after the game, they had a tambola. Now, these are platforms, these are opportunities where people are coming, where they do not have any differences, whether of caste, creed, color, or anything. So I feel that these are opportunities that we can provide to our local people there. And I feel that nothing is impossible. And this is a moment where they need the help. And if we can give them some direction, if we can give them, they are ready to go. And as you know, the hill people there in Darjeeling were always, they always have a ready smile. They're always ready to help. They're ready to, they enjoy their music. And if they are in a happy state of mind like that, I'm sure getting them to do work for themselves and be productive and be proud of where they belong to is something that is not impossible. It is difficult. As in local lingo, they may say, Batocha ukali oralo, but hami pugumla. Basically saying that the road is steep and winding, but we'll get there. Thank you very much.
We will now begin with the fourth and the last session for the day, Environment and Sustainability, Himalayan North Bengal, the Environmental Challenge. I would like to invite on stage Mr. Deb A. Mukherjee, President, the Bengal Chamber, to moderate the session. May I also welcome Professor Joyanto Bondopadhyay to join us here on stage for the session, please. Professor Bondopadhyay is a visiting distinguished fellow of the Observer Research Foundation. He is a researcher and author on science and the natural environment. He received his PhD in engineering from IIT Kanpur in 1975. Professor Bondopadhyay then joined the Center for International Studies at the MIT Cambridge, USA as a visiting postdoctoral fellow. He joined the faculty of IIM Bangalore in 1978 and started to work on public interest knowledge. In 1979, he got deeply involved in understanding the reasons behind the forest rights movement in the Uttarakhand Himalaya, widely known as the Chipko Andolan. In 1988, he left IIM Bangalore and joined the International Center for Integrated Mountain Development, Kathmandu, where he continued to work on environment and development in the Himalaya. In 1993, he joined the International Academy of Environment in Geneva as director of research. In 1997, he was invited by the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta, to join the Center for Development and Environment Policy. He retired as professor from IIM Calcutta in 2012. I would now request Mr. Deb A. Mukherjee, the President, Bengal Chamber, to welcome Professor Bondopadhyay with a flower bouquet. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Shonali. Indeed, a pleasure to have you, Professor Joyanto Bondopadhyay, with us. Now it's the afternoon, this morning and afternoon. And before we engage in a conversation, so to speak, I would like to compliment Bishwajit Mohinta for a wonderful program he has put together. Very well structured, I must say, and the secretariat that has supported you. So we have had some very interesting sessions. We have had a macro overview. We have also touched on some very critical issues. And at the end now, in conclusion, we are talking about the sustainability vis-a-vis the environment, with a specific focus on environment and the sustainability issues in the Himalayan region. So the Himalayan mountains, so to speak. Because it's a very complex topology, I think, Professor Bondopadhyay, you would agree with me, that it's a very complex topology. And the ecological vulnerability of the region is pretty high. Now, we need to understand what is the scenario as it stands and how we could possibly have a resilient ecosystem to balance, and that question has been coming up time and again, to balance economic development in a sustainable manner without environmental degradation, keeping in mind the topography of the Himalayan range, especially the eastern Himalayas, where the topology is quite complex. Professor Bondopadhyay would first give us a global overview, as he puts it, in other mountainous regions, what the global scenario is like, and then he would come down to the Himalayas specifically, which would then trigger a meaningful interaction with all of you, so that we can come to some conclusions, which is very important in terms of the way ahead. How do we now respond to the challenges, and what could be, if I may call it, the prescription to go ahead and manage this region, bring about development without compromising the environment? The impact of climate change is being felt, and is being felt in a very, very strong manner. And we can all feel it, and we will all be affected. So how do we negotiate, in a holistic sense, the sustainability issues and the resilience that we build around it? Over to you, sir, for your initial comments.
Thanks very much. It's a great pleasure for me to be here talking on the challenges in the North Bengal Himalayan region. And I'm extremely happy that the Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industries have taken up a rethinking of approach to economic activities in the broad region, which is not a very clearly laid out region, very rightly, of what is the Himalayan in North Bengal. Now, we can have district-wise understanding, maybe Darjeeling, Kalimpong, etc. At the same time, you have connectivity of this region with far-flung areas in Bhutan, in Nepal, in Bangladesh, in whole of Northeast. So we cannot only stick to a small area while we are encouraging both road-based or water-based connectivity, or even air. Now I will go back to rethinking of mountainous areas, economic activities in mountainous areas. And one basic approach is, economic history shows us that the modern concept of industrial growth is based on flat plains. And the moment we come to industrialization or economic development in the mountain areas, we have to think differently. And that moment has come with the chamber taking up rethinking the Himalayan areas of North Bengal. I'll give you one or two examples. The tea was brought to Kochen by Britishers, and tea revolutionized the economic scenario of Darjeeling. So an alternative concept of economic activity in the mountains will have to identify specific advantages the mountain areas enjoy, which the plains do not have. Tourism is one. While the average temperature in the Indian plains will be 48, 49, people will come to have the cooler weather. And that is the basis of mountain tourism. You give them a cooler weather for some time. You give them a greener environment for some time. So this is exchange of advantages that upland and mountain areas have with respect to other areas. the success of Apple in Himachal was brought by one Mr. Stokes, who was related, got married and came to Himachal. And today Himachal means apple. Apple in fresh apple form, in apple juice form, in various food products. Himachal has become economically very active, a prosperous state, just by taking advantage of the suitability of apple, exactly like the suitability of tea. I will give you one most interesting example of Switzerland, which is a mountainous area of Europe. And why do we have Swiss watches? In the mechanical watch period as the best. Because the Swiss industry did not think that large-scale heavy industrialization is their cup of tea. But they took small lathes and decided that our cup of tea is fine machining, which is small lathes and can be done in a decentralized manner in hill villages, and they flourished small machining, fine machining. That led to the supremacy of Swiss mechanical watches, and it was a global economic success. So it is very important that we have a very theoretical analysis of specific advantages of North Bengal with respect to the surrounding plains, and then have a long-term strategy. Individual items like health, tourism, timber, they're all there, but a comprehensive analytical approach should be the backdrop. So this is where I think we have to rethink how we have gone ahead and how tourism, it's very right that tourism is a very important exchange. You have people coming to enjoy the environment of mountain regions, environment meaning both temperature, fresh air, green vegetation, and they pay for it. There are other ways of specific advantages where the mountains have, like biodiversity. You have the potential of today in the form of medicine. We are going for more organic medicine, and Himalaya can be a major producer. Instead of just getting some sort of illegally extracted medicinal plants from all over Himalaya, we can have a more organized medicinal plant strategy for each Himalayan region. So these specific advantages are the basis of a new concept of economic advancement of mountain areas, including from Jammu Kashmir all the way to Myanmar, this whole Himalayan region. But Himalaya is not a flat plain, stable area. Every day there is an earthquake, whether it is in the eastern edge or in the Nanga Parbat area of the western edge. Somewhere you have an earthquake. Only when the earthquake is above 5.6 in the Richter scale, we note it, because then it causes some damage. But plate tectonics is going on, and Tibet is going up about 2 to 3 centimeters a year. And the plate tectonics, the Indian plate is moving around 3 to 4 centimeters per year. So a tectonically active area is fragile. Second, as long as the Himalaya is standing and the monsoon is coming, we will have a tremendous, what is called anomalous precipitation. The anomalous precipitation that caused the Uttarakhand, I don't call it tragedy, but a natural process of disaster, was because of heavy snowfall. This, we are talking of Darjeeling. Darjeeling has a record of 450 millimeters of rainfall in 24 hours. It was a disaster in Darjeeling, 18 something, long back. So on the tectonic instability, we have this meteorological instability. And both together, the meteorological instability is the basis for further landslides, because the tectonic plates are lubricated by water, and when there is a small amount of water going into the underground, you have landslides. So these are limitations which have to be also rethought. When you are rethinking, you cannot only think of the positive side of the economics, you have to think of the limiting side of the economics. So this is the initial sort of position I will talk about, and then
mind
go for
just making a quick observation here. We understand the tectonic instability. We also understand the meteorological instability, and we have to live with this. And the planning has to happen based on the local situation, the local advantages, and there we need to be a little innovative in our thinking in terms of how we can add value, economic value, to that specific region. Now, is there any way we can build some sort of a resilience in against the instability at all? That's one question. The other question I have is, given the fact that climate change is happening, global warming is happening now, and that is having a huge impact in terms of the meteorological instability, like the rainfall pattern, the hydrological cycles, and the precipitation levels, etc. Is there any corrective action you could propose? Is that at all a possibility?
Corrective action is always a possibility if you have good science. Unfortunately, our particularly in the Himalayan context, our science has not been very strong. And even if there is good science, it has not been followed by good engineering. You might have ecological understanding, but engineering has been too structural. And we need a modernization of engineering for mountain areas, where the multidisciplinary impacts have to be studied. Now, when we talk of the advantages of the North Bengal region, one thing that I have written extensively is that in coming 40 to 50 years, we may have to change our attitude towards what is the best product that this region can give us. And I think the way the situation of water is going, mountain land can produce fruits, can produce crops, can produce timber, but we have not considered in any sort of mountain economics paper that land's most important product is water. Because you can damage the water by bad land management, you can conserve the water by good land management, but as long as that product of water is not priced, no one will bother. Everyone will say, environmental degradation is there, but I am getting my crops, I am getting my agriculture, I am getting my road. So as long as a regional pricing of safe water water security on the downstream. And in the coming 30, 40 years, whether it is Tista or Ganga or any other thing, there has to be and there will be a negotiated sharing of both water and money. And this is what is called the payment for ecosystem services. And in every meeting of the chief ministers of Himalayan states, and it was in the 13th Finance Commission recognized that PES, payment for ecosystem services, is necessary, but how to pay, what to pay, and how that payment can go into the sharing by local people. These are governance issues that are probably one can have a subcommittee on the payment of ecosystem services governance. So there is a lot of rethinking to be done. But I must say that add to this the whole issue of first global warming and then climate change, because the Himalaya is affected more by global warming than by climate change. Himalaya is warming at a rate 3 to 4 times higher than the plains. And the Himalayan glaciers are under much stronger sort of threat. And that means our rivers are under similar sort of instability. And if these areas can properly arrange for a payment for ecosystem services, investment has to come for water storage in the upstream. It has to come on the how the land can be used for conservation of river flows, and the whole economics of areas like North Bengal can be based on selling water rather than selling oranges. Because water is going to be much, much more badly sought after in 50 years or 60 years.
I think, sir, you have raised a very, very important point. Two things, two takeaways. One is ecosystem service and the governance aspect of it. And I think that's a very, very valid point which we need to look at even for our vision document. Vishali, I think you will also agree with me. The second point you raised about water, and I can see that you are advocating pricing of water, and I couldn't agree with you more on that, because it is no longer just the popular perception that it's God's gift to mankind and we should not just bother about water, because water is going to be a very, very big issue and a critical issue which could or would potentially could affect all of us. In terms of the risk analysis, sir, I have a question. Where do you see us? Because the Himalayan ecosystem, the global warming bit that you raised, and the impact of climate change is a consequence of it. And then the water, coupled with it, it's directly affecting the water resource, correct? Now, in terms of a risk analysis, where do you think we stand today? Is it an alarming situation? Or what is the time frame we have? How bad is it, if I may ask? Is it very critical?
Whether it is critical or not depends on how seriously you take hydrological changes. But the time frame is 30 years.
That's quite bad.
In the next 30 years,
yes.
Much of the glaciers will melt out.
Right.
And if they melt out, then you will have very low flow in the March, April, May, June period, pre-monsoon, water scarce period.
It's being felt even now.
Yes.
It is being felt now.
The process is going on, but the process, by 30 years, it will be all over. It will be very, very low flow in the month when we need Rabi irrigation. Rabi irrigation is needed, but there will not be that. whole irrigation system of Punjab, West UP, are based on Rabi irrigation.
Absolutely. And that is what brings me to the next question on water harvesting and smart irrigation. Now, do you see water harvesting as an option to be considered, especially in North Bengal, looking at North Bengal? And how best, sorry, and how best we can improve in the water management in terms of irrigation and cultivation, vis-a-vis cultivation? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Absolutely. I think we have to have all the North Bengal rivers to have a more sort of uniform hydrograph. And that is a major water management challenge. If you have a July boom and then October dry, that is one way. But if you have proper management, you can at least extend the scarcity from October to February. And that will be very much needed in the coming decades. So water harvesting is a matter of life and death. You cannot say, I will not do, it is my choice. You have to do, and that is why pricing of water is important.
That is important.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we will not be serious about it. Otherwise, it doesn't.
No one will. If I do not get proper price, why should I harvest water? I will say I will use the water for my irrigation, or rather than downstream irrigation.
I have a slightly unrelated question. Maybe this is slightly governance, on the point of governance. Water happens to be a state subject. And often we find this becomes a contentious issue amongst states. And there is no central regulatory body that can come up, even at the policy level, as to what should be done in terms of conservation, efficiency, and different measures to manage water more efficiently. What are your thoughts on this? Do you think we need some sort of a radical change in the thought process?
The radical change has already occurred globally.
Exactly.
It is for us to introduce those changes into our own management. Most countries are now going for river basin oriented management, whether the river basin is transboundary, international, or transboundary in terms of states. We cannot manage Tista by ignoring Sikkim.
Exactly.
You cannot say that Tista is a North Bengal outflow river, Gajaldoba and downstream. You have to bring whole of Sikkim in it. So we need
rethinking.
Absolute rethinking and governance change on water, if we have to survive.
I think that's a very, very valid, important point you have raised, you have flagged up. Could we have some observations or any questions from the floor? Maybe a little bit of interaction. How are we doing time-wise? I forgot to ask.
We are a little beyond time.
So another 5 minutes?
Yeah, 5 minutes.
So any observations or,
sir?
Yes, yes, please. Is there a mic or you can take my mic?
Thank you, Jayanto. I was delighted to discover that he and I are from the same batch, although we have been separated.
Yes, by 5 years we studied together.
Oh, wonderful. And you discovered only today?
Yep.
Oh, wonderful.
No, anyway, I discovered him. He is much more popular than me.
He's a public face.
Yeah. Getting back to your question, that water is a state subject, so what do we do about it? This is, we have central agencies like the Central Water Commission, but their jurisdiction is severely circumscribed by the constitutional provisions, and these cause problems. Also, what Jayanto said, that we cannot think of Tista without taking into account Sikkim. We also have to take into account Bangladesh.
Absolutely.
Because lower riparian states have a right to water even if there is a scarcity. Even the scarcity has to be apportioned. But we have been able to do it with Pakistan. There is no reason why we should not be able to do it with a friendly country like Bangladesh. But the problem of it being a state subject and the center not having sufficient authority on it, it can be set right if necessary by a constitutional amendment. After all, a constitution is meant for the people. It's not that the people are meant for
absolutely.
The constitution.
It's a living document. It's a absolutely, because increasingly it's my, I also feel that a regulatory mechanism and a central policy making is required, and otherwise we will never be able to resolve these issues.
But with a caveat,
yes,
that you have an intermediate level of river basins.
Absolutely.
That Tista is more directly linked with Sikkim, West Bengal, downstream Bangladesh, all the way up to its point joining Brahmaputra.
Right.
Here, you must give river basin a priority rather than at the federal government level where other interests might come. So I have studied also how quickly China established the Yellow River Commission.
Right.
And when Yellow River was going dry at the mouth, today they have totally changed the agricultural pricing system and irrigation system, so that they have a fabulous flow at the delta. And though Chinese government is centrally very strong, the river basin authorities are given full scientific sort of freedom and management authority to suggest what should be done at the river basin level.
So it's a good model.
Yeah, a state, river basin, federal.
Yeah, that's a good structure.
Yeah.
That's a good structure. Any other observation or questions? Yes, madam.
Thank you. Professor Bondopadhyay, could you give an example of how payment for eco-services works? Is it already happening somewhere in India or internationally?
Yes, internationally many are happening. Murray Darling in Australia, where if I can, I am an upstream irrigation fellow. I have, suppose, 1,000 liters of allocation. If I can manage my irrigation with 900 units, I save 10 units or 100 units for downstream, and I get a payment for having that saved. Murray Darling was also having the same fate as the Yellow River, and Murray Darling has been rehabilitated by promoting higher efficiency in the upstream. So these are the two very good examples, Yellow River and the Murray Darling. In India so far, I would not say that there is any still organized institutional structure for payment, but talks are going on. I was involved in a meeting at Shimla of chief ministers of the Himalayan states. I actually initiated this whole idea that payment for, and then it was followed by acceptance in the 13th Finance Commission. But then theoretical analysis that is needed, who pays to whom, how much to pay, those research activities are still not very completely done. But I think the process is on.
Thank you very much. If there are no other questions, any other question? So we will draw the session to a close now. And again, a big thank you to Professor Jayanta Bandyopadhyay for very interesting. I know this has been a short session, but very valid suggestions, advice have come out And we really appreciate your thoughts, sir. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you very much, sir. May I now welcome Mr. Biswajit Mohinta, Chairperson, North Bengal Committee of the Bengal Chamber, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, all of you. We come to the close of this conclave. We go back with an experience. I hope you all of you will agree that this transformation process, which we were thinking, you know, this has really lot of avenues and paths has come up in this session, you know, which we have to really integrate. Again, I'll use the word integration and converge and bring them together. But one particular thing from my side, what I felt is this: amongst the stakeholders, you know, there are different stakeholders, and it's a complex process to bring about the transformation. Because somebody asked me a question, or in our panel discussion session, that 70 years, why things have not changed? So how things will change? Yes, that's a very valid question. But obviously, we have to make a beginning. And what Mr. Hoon has particularly mentioned, that obviously it has to be a professional entity or a group of entities and a government to people. That is my personal feeling. The government to people, this interface is very, very important for any such transformation process. So, we on behalf of the North Bengal Committee and Bengal Chamber of Commerce would expect or really look forward to your more support of taking ahead our mission for North Bengal. And thank you very much. Especially we thank our sponsors, Himalayan Endeavor Group, Himali School, Calcutta Tea Trading Association, and this Golden Tips. Golden Tips, incidentally, is one of the largest online platform at the moment. They are doing different names. Even Himali School, this is a school which belongs to one of my school alumni only, and it is doing wonderfully well. Actually, if you really go through the Google, you will see that it is ranked one as one of the best boarding schools in India. And obviously the Tea Trading Association, they have been also working for the cause of tea together. And I come to the Himalayan Endeavor Group. They are really looking forward, and obviously I'm also associated with them in the sense that we are trying to do something together, and they also are a big part in really supporting the cause for North Bengal. So I finally would thank all of you once more and come to the close, and we will all join together for the lunch now. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.